Good morning, everyone. We're going to begin. If people could get seated, that would be great. I'm Jean Finch. I'm the director of the Student Community Development Specialization based in the School of Social Welfare, and I'm very pleased to help host this morning's event. And it's my pleasure to bring Dr. Peter Bajant, Vice President for Student Affairs, to the podium for his welcome and to start this morning's work. Peter.
Good morning. Today's speaker, Jennifer Engle, will be introduced, and you've got programs that describe her involvement in this area of work. Dr. Engle and her team will also be on campus for 2 days, this afternoon and tomorrow, helping us think through what opportunities we have to better plan, coordinate our efforts in graduating low SES students. Allowing us probably to see the forest, not focusing on the trees. As a campus, we've got a storied example of how we do support and graduate low SES students through the EOP program, which totals approximately 600 students, yet a third of our students are Pell eligible, and how to scale these efforts out and supplement the efforts is important for the university to understand. The inclusion of low SES in higher education is not solely an American US problem. Many of the European countries, Australasia, have policy strategies to bring into higher education what they would describe as working class students. This is an ongoing effort in the United States and abroad, but it's also something that has to be balanced against resources, and those of you who read the morning papers would see that the House budget just released last night called for the reduction of Pell and a redescription of the loan programs, which is going to make it very difficult to expand those programs in the future. The one thing I would like to point out and recognize is a portion of the Education Trust's core beliefs. We believe in the power of education to close the gaps that separate low-income students and students of color from other young Americans. We believe that schools and colleges, appropriately organized, can help virtually all students master the knowledge they need to succeed. And the last piece that I would pick out is, we believe long-standing gaps in opportunity, achievement, and attainment have roots inside and outside the schools, and that we know. And though we know these gaps are stubborn, we also know they're not inevitable. With that, I would like to turn the mic back to my good colleague.
Thank you, Peter. Dr. Engle and our panelists that are sitting in the audience, Vice Provost Robbins, who's with us this morning, Vice President Bajant, Dean Brisbane is also with us this morning, faculty, students, colleagues, staff, and guests, welcome to the 17th Annual Leadership Symposium. It's my job to explain the work of this morning and to introduce our speakers, and I'll introduce them shortly to you, but let me just acknowledge them now. Dr. Engle is with us on the stage, and then in the audience we have Dr. David Bynum, and Assistant Provost Cheryl Hamilton, and three seniors from Stony Brook University, Pierre Albert, Diana Lennis, and Paris Tyson. They're scattered through the audience, and they'll join the stage following Dr. Engle's speech. So This morning, for an event such as this, there are a lot of people to thank, and I want to acknowledge that this year's symposium is supported by the Office of the Provost. Dr. Engle's lecture is part of the Provost Lecture Series. We've had support from that office in advertising, and thank you, Vice Provost Robbins and his assistant, Nadine Greenstein. As usual, the SCD Advisory Board has been a valuable resource. Jerry Stein, Dallas Bowman, Judy Siegel, Betty Jean Race, Richard Morgan, Nikki Barnett, and Jean Peden. A special thank you, of course, to Dallas Bowman, who's been a mobilizing and vital force in sustaining the process. Thank you, Dallas. Thank you, each of you. This year's symposium is also part of the Student Affairs Professional Development Series, and Sue DeMonda has been busy attending to many of the details today's event. The current SCD students are with us, distributing the program with labels, helping you to your seats, Taryn Kaduchin, Angela Albergo, and Donnie Sheenan. They can help you with any questions that you have in managing this facility. But it's the ongoing support from the Office of the Vice President for Student Affairs, as over the past 17 years, which has maintained this effort. Also essential is the support from Dean Brisbane, who without her, she keeps me focused on this task and allows this my involvement in this rewarding endeavor. So please help me with a round of applause to everyone who's helped this morning. Thank you. The Leadership Symposium has been part of the SED since it began, and one of the goals of this event is to engage in a discussion relating to challenges facing college campuses and to foster meaningful dialogue within our learning community. And the topics addressed during the past 16 years have ranged over a number of issues that exemplify the values and special collaboration that's been forged between social work and student affairs on this campus. This partnership is a unique venture. It combines and extends social work and student affairs practice to prepare MSW students to focus on the essential components of community building in higher education. The collaboration involves co-teaching, sharing of resources, and finding mutual purpose. What brings us together is our shared vision of campus community as a vehicle for enhancing social justice and civic responsibility, and our mutual commitment to promote student development and student success. Today's symposium is a vibrant example of these shared concerns. So this year's focus, Closing the Gaps, Promoting Access and Success for Low-Income Students, builds upon previous symposiums. But today's focus responds to the widening economic disparities and the resulting additional challenges for low-income students in their quest for access and success within higher education. Peter mentioned the changes in Pell. Congress passed Pell eligibility and length of time students may be supported under Pell. These changes will increase the barriers that students face. The maximum family income cap under which students automatically qualify for a full Pell grant has been reduced from $30,000 to $23,000. From 32 to 23. And where students formerly could receive a maximum of 18 full-time semesters of Pell Grant awards, Peter mentioned, this is now reduced to 12 semesters. We know that monetary support alone is not all that's required, but these changes will directly impact our students already at risk in their persistence to graduation. We here at Stony Brook have achieved success in our efforts to support low-income students, and for this, we have much to be proud. Today's focus recognizes our desire to sustain these efforts and our need to understand ways to go forward and to improve our outcomes. And our panelists are well prepared to help us consider these issues. But before I introduce Dr. Engle, I'd like to provide information about how we will work together this morning. You'll see from your brochure that we'll be working together here in the theater. for the entire morning. Dr. Engle will speak, and we will take questions from her presentation, and then we'll take a short break. At that point, the respondents and the panelists will join the stage and will continue our work. As the issues are complex, we will have our speakers in the second part of this follow one another so that questions can be tackled from all of the perspectives presented. And in order to achieve this, we've distributed some index cards so that you can jot down any questions that you may have as we move along in the program. We'll be taking questions from the audience directly, but if you prefer, you can hand us the index cards and we'll read them for you. But we have plenty of mics and opportunity for you to come and to pose your questions. So we're all eager to get started. I'll introduce the respondents and the students when they join us on the stage, and right now I'd like to introduce Dr. Engle. Dr. Engle first came to our attention from her recent chapter in Adriana Kizar's post-structural analysis, Recognizing and Serving Low-Income Students. Dr. Engle's chapter, Demography is Not Destiny, What Colleges and Universities Can Do to Improve Persistence Among Low-Income Students, outlines promising practices and asks provocative questions to prompt reconsideration of assumptions underlying institutional responses to low-income students. Dr. Engle's role as Director of Higher Education, Education Research and Policy at the Education Trust positions her to lead the research agenda of the Higher Education Division and the data analysis of the Access to Success Initiative of the Trust. In addition, she manages the College Results Online, a public access tool to facilitate comparisons of college success rates. It's a fascinating tool. We were playing with it, and it's very user-friendly and very informative. Dr. Engle's employment history is centered within organizations that focus on opportunity within higher education. These include serving as the senior research analyst at the Pell Institute, a project manager for the Council for Opportunity in Education, and an education program specialist for the U.S. Department of Education, where she evaluated grant proposals for the Women's Education Equity Act and the Native Alaskan Native Hawaiian Grant Program. Her consistent pursuit of access, equity, and education, and her concern for promoting success indicates a passion and commitment to the issues that we're facing before us today. So with no further ado, please help me in welcoming Dr. Engle to the podium. Dr. Engle.
Thank you so much for that really warm welcome. As you said, I'm Jennifer Engle. I'm with the Education Trust. The Education Trust, for those of you who don't know us, we're an advocacy organization. We're based in Washington, D.C., focused on closing achievement gaps from kindergarten through college. And the work that we do at the Education Trust is really personal for me. I'm from a working class family in Ohio, was the first person in my family to go to college, and I just kept going. So I really know the power on a personal level of education to change your life trajectory, and I want to make sure that those same opportunities are available not only to my own children, but to all children. So thank you again for the invitation to speak with you here today about what we know from the national research about closing gaps in college access and college success. I hope that our conversation over the course of the morning will be really helpful to you and support your efforts to help students, low-income students and minority students succeed on your campus. The work that you're doing today, and we've heard a bit about this already, is extremely important and extremely timely because closing achievement gaps has never been more urgent than it is today. As you know, President Obama has set a goal for us once again to reclaim our spot as the best educated country in the world, and to do that is going to take a lot of work. We're going to need to produce more than 8 million additional degrees above and beyond what we are currently producing by 2020 in order to meet that goal. It's a very ambitious goal indeed. There's no way that we can reach that goal without expanding access and improving success for populations that have been traditionally underserved in higher education, low income and minority students. So how are we doing on that front? On the access side, we actually have seen a lot of improvement over the last several decades. We've seen college going on the rise for all groups of students. Today, about 70% of high school graduates go directly on to college. But even as we've seen college access rise for all groups of students, we also see that there are pretty significant gaps that remain. When you look in particular at low-income students today are going to college at rates that are lower than high-income students went to college nearly 40 years ago. So we still have a lot of work to do on the access front, in particular for our low-income populations. There's also the question about access to what? For low-income students and students of color, there are real gaps in the types of institutions that they're gaining access to. We see an increasing stratification in higher education along race and income. As you can see here, African American and Latino students are underrepresented at public and private four-year institutions and overrepresented in particular at for-profit institutions. For-profit institutions, we know, on average have especially low graduation rates, and the amount of debt that students incur is especially high. When we look at the data on low-income students, we see that even our best-prepared low-income students are very likely to undermatch into less selective institutions with lower graduation rates. So public four-year institutions like Stony Brook that are committed to serving low-income and minority student populations are really critical to the college attainment agenda. There are also questions, and we've talked about this already as well this morning, about access at what costs. We have an affordability crisis in higher education right now. State support for higher education is down, way down. The Pell Grant is continually under attack. We see that tuitions are skyrocketing. The burden of paying for college is shifting dramatically to low-income students, to students and their family, and the greatest burdens are being borne by those who have the least ability to pay, low-income students and their family. When you look at the data here, you can see low-income students must devote an amount equivalent to 72% of their family income every year to be able to attend a four-year institution. And this is after all sources of grant aid. This is after the Pell Grant, after their state grant, after their institutional grant. They still have to come up with about $11,000. Certainly there are loans available. Stafford loans only go up to about $5,500 for freshmen. So this is an extraordinary amount for low-income students and their families to finance on an annual basis to go to a four-year institution. By comparison, you can see that high-income families spend about 15% of their family income on an annual basis to go to a four-year institution. This graph here represents almost every four-year institution in the country, and it's a little bit of a complicated graph, so I'll spend a little time talking through it. The institutions in the bottom right quadrant have both an affordable net price for low-income students, and they graduate at least half of their students. And by affordable, we mean that they expect their low-income students to pay no more than high-income students pay on average nationally, which is about 15% of their family income. So using that bar, we see that there's actually pretty few affordable quality options for low-income students in terms of four-year institutions in the country. Stony Brook actually does pretty well relative to the landscape of opportunity here. Stony Brook serves a large proportion of Pell students, graduates them at rates much higher than the national average, but the net price for low-income students may still be out of reach for a number of them. So we've talked about some of the barriers in terms of access. We've talked about some of the barriers in terms of affordability. But you all know from your work here, there are many students who overcome those barriers and come on college campuses every fall looking to get that degree. Unfortunately, what we see is that many of them still face significant barriers to earning the degree once they get on campus. As you can see here, about 6 in 10 white students earn a degree within 6 years, which I don't think any of us think that's good enough either. But when we look at the data for our underrepresented minority students, we see that African American and Latino students, only about 4 in 10 earn that degree within 6 years. And low-income students, we see gaps as well. So when you add it all up, when you look at the cumulative effect of these persistent gaps in access and the persistent gaps in success, we see that young people of color and from families of modest means are much less likely than their counterparts to earn a degree. This is a massive waste of talent and opportunity, particularly given how hard we know so many of these students have worked just to get to college and overcome those barriers. But it's just not a waste for those individual students. It's a waste for us collectively. It hurts our economy, and it hurts our democracy. The changing demographics of our country in particular demand that we better serve this population, low-income, underrepresented minority students, if we are going to have a healthy economy and democracy moving forward. But the question that we often are asked and that we ask ourselves is, can we do anything about it? And I think that when we're presented with this problem, many of us, even those of us who care deeply and are very committed to fixing it, we worry. You know, we worry that the barriers that our students face are maybe just too much to overcome. And when the Ed Trust started working on this issue and began working with colleges, we frequently heard this from institutions. You know, folks would often say, we just can't be expected to graduate more of our students. They aren't prepared, they work too much, they have too many obligations outside of school. They and we are doing the best that we can. So in 2005, the Education Trust developed College Results Online, really to test this assumption out. And what College Results Online does, it's a web tool. It allows you to look up almost any four-year institution in the country and see how that institution compares to its most similar peer institutions. And the way that we select the peer institutions is we take into account the 15 or so input factors, the factors that we know from the research have a relationship and impact graduation rates. For instance, the academic preparation of the incoming class and the diversity of the student body. And what we find time and time again is that even after taking these input factors into account, there's still a lot of variation in output, meaning graduation rates and graduation rate gaps. In other words, some institutions are serving their students, in particular their students of color and their low-income students, better than similar institutions. And so what that means to us is that while graduation rate gaps that we see nationally are large and they are persistent, they're not, as some might argue, inevitable. And Stony Brook is an example of that here. Here you can see, and you all know, that low-income and minority students at Stony Brook are actually outperforming their peers in terms of graduation rates. And Stony Brook is actually alone among its peer group in having no graduation rate gap, even though Stony Brook is actually one of the most diverse institutions among its peer group as well in College Results Online. This is a historical trend. At Stony Brook, there's consistently been no gap for minority students over time, even as rates have improved for all groups of students. And minority graduation rates at Stony Brook put the campus in the top third of their peer group. Now, when we look at the overall data, we do see that Stony Brook ranks lower in its peer group on overall graduation rate. So the challenge for Stony Brook is really how to maintain what you've already accomplished in terms of access and equity and relative affordability while making sure that you improve outcomes for all of your students. So I want to share with you a story and some information that we've learned from Florida State University. There are a lot of similarities in the student body between Stony Brook and Florida State, certainly lots of differences as well, geographical and others. But Florida State is an institution that we've worked with, we've profiled in our work, and they were facing a similar situation when they took on the kind of work that you all are taking on here. They wanted to improve their success rates overall, but they wanted to do it in a way that maintained their commitment to serving low-income and minority students equitably and well. So I'm going to share with you a bit about their story. Florida State actually used a very data-driven process to go about this work. And you'd expect, given their national reputation, that they really could have just relied on recruiting the best students, not just in the state, but really anywhere in the country, to improve in the way that they have here. But what we learned by talking with administrators and staff at Florida State is that they work exceptionally hard to make sure that all of their students graduate, in particular, their low-income, first-generation, and minority students. So I'm going to talk with you about work that they undertook over the course of about a decade under the direction of their retired provost, Larry Abel. So when we talk to institutions that have made the kind of gains that Florida State has, there's almost always a top administrator who's a self-described data nut, as Larry describes himself here. Now, Larry's actually a scientist by training, And so this kind of work, it was instinctual for him to look at the data. But when we've talked to other institutions as well, we've found provosts who were religion professors or humanity professors that were similarly focused on the data for their institutions. And as Larry says here, you really don't need any statistical background. It's nothing more than common sense. More often than not, he was really just looking at an Excel spreadsheet. He wasn't looking at sophisticated data analyses. But the point was, he was looking at the data, he was asking questions about the data, and he was acting on it on a regular basis. One very common sense analysis that they did at Florida State was simply disaggregating their yearly retention rates across a number of cohorts. And what they found was that low-income students and students of color, they don't drop out in the same ways as their peers do at Florida State. Their white students, in this case, their white female students, they tend to drop out in a typical way, in the way that we expect. They mostly drop out in the first year, and then they drop out at lower and lower rates over time. But when they disaggregated the data and they looked at, in this case, African-American male low-income students, they found that they drop out all along the path to a degree, sometimes with higher dropout rates in the second year, the third year, or even the fifth year. And so what Larry says is, you know, initially we threw everything into the first year and we realized that wasn't a good strategy for these students. You have to use your resources for the long term. You have to stay with these students all 4 or 5 years. They need the same advisor the whole time, tutoring the whole time. It has to be all the time. So I want to share this quote from Paul Thayer from Colorado State University. Paul is someone that I have met a number of years ago when I used to work with TRIO programs, and he's done a lot of work in that area. And I think that this quote really typifies the way that they approach this at Florida State. Essentially, what he says is that strategies that work for low-income and first-generation students, these are likely to be successful for the general student population. But when you have strategies that are designed with the general student population in mind, and they don't take into account the circumstances and characteristics of low-income, first-generation, minority students, they're not as likely to be successful. And so what they did at Florida State, you know, their approach was really, you need a foundation of support for all students. You need those mandatory orientation programs. You need a robust first year program. But then you need pillars of support for different groups of students that are responsive to the challenges that they're facing all along the pathway to getting that degree. And thinking about those pathways, you know, one of the things that they did at Florida State was they wanted to think about how can we better help our students negotiate their way through the institution to be successful and get that degree. And this is particularly important for first-generation students who really don't have that kind of social and cultural capital to know how to navigate a college campus. And so they weren't systematic about it at first, they admit. But eventually, Larry and his team developed a series of action steps, 93 of them, to be precise. They were very precise about it, tied to every month of the academic calendar. And these action steps included emailing students when their grade point averages went down in a given term. They actually also emailed students when their grade point averages went up. They wanted to make sure that they wanted students to know that someone was looking out for them, someone was interested in them, whether they were doing good or bad. Reaching out to students when they were placed on academic warning or probation, reaching out to students who had earned 40 hours but they hadn't declared a major yet. So really the key about these steps was there was a time frame and there was a person that was responsible for every one of these steps. And that leads us to the next step in their process, which was FSU formed a cross-campus retention team that met weekly to go over, as Larry says here, not the data, but the students within the data. So Larry is actually really adamant that there has to be a team with representatives from across the campus that meets weekly, not monthly. He says monthly is too long. You need to meet weekly to identify roadblocks to student retention and to assign clear responsibility for removing those roadblocks. And at Florida State, the team consisted of about 20 people from offices all over campus, including orientation, advising, financial aid, undergraduate research. The team was convened on a weekly basis by Larry as the provost and was supported by the Institutional Research Office. So as you might expect, based on what you've learned about Larry so far, and I use his name, you know, just Larry, he's a very powerful, persuasive person in telling the story that they, what they've done at Florida State. But as you might expect from what you know about him so far, he required team members to regularly record and report data on their action steps. So they came to the weekly meeting with data on their students and what they'd done to help their students that week. Advisors, in particular, were required to record every interaction with students by time of day, day of week, method of contact, as well as students' frequently asked questions. And Larry would actually review all of this data. As he says here, they know I'm paying attention to it, that I care about it, that I talk to them about it. Monitoring data and responding to it can be a powerful cultural change on campus. Now, they put in place a lot of reforms while they were doing this work, and many of them are probably familiar to you. Again, those first year programs, learning communities, supplemental instruction. They put a lot of programs into place at FSU, and they've got actually a lot of data on those programs. But what Larry says the first thing he'd do if he were starting over again are academic maps. So back in 2003, Larry and his team crafted an online guide, and it lists the courses that students need to take term by term for every academic major to make sure that they graduate on time. And as Larry said, you know, what could be more simple than that? If students go off the map for their major, there's a hold put on their registration, and they have to get in contact with their advisors. What's really instructive about this process, though, is that when Larry and his team sat down to do this exercise, they thought it would be really straightforward. They got the same materials that they send to students, they got the course catalog, they got some departmental information, and they found that they, as adults with PhDs working at the institution, couldn't do it. And so, again, it speaks to how do we expect low-income, first-generation students to navigate an institution, and what are the barriers of the institution's own making? You know, we frequently think about the barriers that students themselves bring with them, and those are real. We can't ignore that students do face challenges, but there are often institutional barriers that can be removed that are not of the student's making, and this is an example of one of them. And so, again, data being central, Larry tracked data on every service, every intervention, and when possible, even conducted randomized trials of interventions to show impact for programs that they put in place. He was a scientist, as I said. As an example, though, the advisors were really central to the retention strategy at Florida State, and Larry put the data that he collected on advisors to good use. And so this is in Larry's words. He says, by monitoring time of day and day of week, we realized, why are we open from 8 a.m. to 11? This is the advising office. It's stupid, quote unquote. So we moved the advisors to the student center from noon to 8, and we put them in the library on Sundays. So by closely looking at the data, tracking student usage, they were able to identify what works, what doesn't work, and to make decisions accordingly. And as he says here, I like to report everything because you never know what's going to inform you about making a decision to intervene for students. And this is the result. They've seen their rates go up overall, and we've seen that they've been able to close and maintain no gap in graduation rate between their underrepresented minority students and their overall population. So what that tells and means to us is that demography is not destiny. What institutions do to help their students succeed actually matters a lot. It's not just about what students bring with them, it's about what institutions do to help students be successful. And I think what we learned from the Florida State story and from a number of other institutions that we've talked with as well, it's not really about bold reforms. When you look at what they did at Florida State, these weren't taking on huge projects. It's about being intentional, and it's about executing in a quality way. Thank you. So we can take questions now. Yes.
Have other institutions done these kind of maps? It seems like it's a pretty common sense thing to do.
So when we talked with Larry, he has met with colleagues across the country. He said that San Diego State and Georgia State both put those maps into effect after they did at Florida State and saw similar kinds of gains. Thank you.
we actually created a department for retention and through the Vice President of Student Affairs Office, because the overall graduation rate was very low. Mm-hmm. And as they saw the same thing and tracking it each year, they saw that actually the minority groups' graduation rate, especially the African American population, is actually higher than the white institutions, mm-hmm. The white students. So it's really interesting to see it from a different perspective.
Well, Georgia State,
I'm sure that everybody can hear.
Oh, okay.
There are mics at the end.
So oh, okay.
Could the SED students help with mics, please, so that everyone can hear the questions?
Well, it raises an interesting point. So Georgia State is another institution that we've worked with and learned from their retired provost as well. And what they found was, you know, they actually hadn't originally differentiated a strategy for different populations. They really were just trying to look at their first year strategy in particular, because what they found was, even though their year-to-year retention rate was pretty high by national standards, they had an 80% retention rate, the percentage of students who were accumulating enough credit to be a sophomore was like 20%. So even though students were coming back on campus that next fall, they realized that they actually weren't, they didn't have enough academic momentum to be successful from that sophomore year on. So they had a really kind of robust try to lift all boats strategy, but what they found was that African American students in particular not only participated in the activities that they put out more frequently, but they also benefited more from them. So I think that, again, when you're mindful and design strategies that are sensitive to the needs of those populations, you can actually see greater benefit for them. Mm-hmm. Sorry, we'll go there and then there.
I don't think I need a microphone. One of the issues that we know matters is with transfer students. Mm-hmm. You haven't really commented about them. Is there anything you can learn from what Florida State did to graduation rates
and transfer students? So we don't have, so this data, and unfortunately the national data, there's really a dearth. We don't, IPEDS doesn't collect data on students who transfer. We don't really have reliable transfer out data or data on what happens to transfer students when they come in and how they get out. So from a national perspective, it's not something we're able to look at very closely. But I do know that a number of public institutions, particularly in the Cal State system and also in the Florida system, because they've got a pretty strong 2+2 model that they've really built some of their state policy around. And so some of their institutions, I know, are doing a good job of bringing transfers in. I don't know as much about how well they're getting them out. But the University of Central Florida and I'd have to look to see which the other one is. The two institutions that are closest to Miami-Dade and Valencia College, they've got a really strong transfer articulation program that includes supports where students are almost dually admitted when they go into the community college, and then they've got advisors that follow them through to the four-year campus.
For years, the University of Virginia has had one of the highest graduation rates for underrepresented, starting underrepresented students. Questioning whether or not the trust has done any review of the processes that they've initiated. Similar, I'm quite sure, to what's going on in Florida State, whether or not the trust has instituted and researched some of the activities that they're incorporating in their retention and graduation rate.
We've not looked closely at the University of Virginia, more so on their income, their UVA access program. We've taken a look at that, and what we've seen in a number of these access programs, there are institutions like UVA and UNC that have initiated these access programs covering more costs or most or all of the costs for low-income students. And what we found is that it's actually improving retention rates for the low-income students who are enrolled, but they're not doing a lot of work to bring more of those low-income students in. So just, I know more about that piece of it than the other work that they've done.
I was wondering, do you have any data on what students are actually doing during that year? In particular, do they actually come to class? And whether, those are wondering whether what percentage of Florida State students are commuters.
You know, I don't know offhand the number of Florida State students who are commuters, but I do think, you know, what we've seen is that a number of institutions are doing a lot of work around these leading indicators or momentum points. Early warning systems is one kind of iteration of that. So giving faculty a sense of how well, and students themselves, how well they're doing very early in the term, because we know from the research that, you know, the number of credits that students accumulate in that first year is very highly correlated with whether they're going to complete, you know, the the proportion of their courses that they complete successfully in that first term or the first year is really predictive of whether or not they complete, how well they make it through the remedial sequence and into that first college credit math and English course. These are all things that we can know about students in their first or second term that help us understand whether or not they're going to be successful. So institutions like Florida State and some of these other schools are doing a lot with that kind of early momentum indicators and using those warning systems to make sure that they're looking at that systematically.
So question?
I don't know that we have a good data source on that. Again, that's not something that's collected through IPEDS, which is the federal higher ed database. Some of the longitudinal studies that NCES does would have some data on that, but I don't know that that's collected on an institution by institution basis in a way that we could look at.
Jennifer, if you could go back to the slide where they showed the trajectory of the mapping of each intervention for Florida. It actually looked like after they started collecting data, they went down for a year.
That's right.
Was that a structural issue? Because we're looking at some of those things at Stony Brook. Mm-hmm. Was that a policy change or a change in data?
So, you know, this is actually an interesting part of the story that I probably shouldn't have left out. So thank you. I'll give you your $10 afterwards. You know, what Larry says and says quite forcefully is you have to do this work for 5 years relentlessly without blinking. This is not something that happens overnight. There's not a silver bullet. You know, you increase retention student by student, you know, one student at a time. And so, you know, when he came in as a new provost and he convened this weekly meeting, not a lot of folks were happy about having a weekly retention meeting at first. And they said, you know, we really don't have time. This meeting conflicts. And he said, that's okay. We'll do it at 6 a.m. You know, and so they met at 6 a.m. For a couple of weeks, and then folks decided, you know, maybe we could make this happen at 8 a.m. So he actually put a lot of himself and his own kind of personal capital staked on this process and staked in these meetings, and unfortunately, the rates did dip initially. And there's actually in the kind of organizational change literature something called an implementation dip, and they very much experienced that here. But it wasn't until they started getting success that he got buy-in from not only the group that he was working with, but with other folks from around campus. So it is a nice reminder about what this work looks like and how you need to stick it out in a lot of cases, because you don't necessarily know, even with as much data as they had, you don't always know right away whether what you're doing is successful.
Can we borrow this slide?
Yes.
What role, if any, did the students have in this process?
So they actually did partner with student government on a number of the reforms that they put in place. The student government president was part of the retention team, not for every meeting, but was a part of the retention team. And, you know, as Larry says quite pragmatically, student government has a bigger budget than the president sometimes, and that was certainly the case at Florida State. And so when they were realizing, for instance, that students needed more tutoring, they went to student government, they partnered with student government, and student government gave some of its funds to do this tutoring in the library that they did. And there was an online system where students could sign up ahead of time and get a full hour, or they could drop in for 20 minutes. And so they actually did a fair amount of partnering with students on that front.
But what about the students who were involved, the students who you were looking to make more successful? Mm-hmm. Did they have any role in this process, or was it just external forces coming in and saying, this is what you're going to do?
Well, I mean, they did a lot of things in addition to partnering with student government. You know, their CARE program at Florida State is really kind of their EOP program. It's very focused on low-income, first-generation populations. It's really got a pipeline effect. And so those students are really looked to as leaders on the campus, and so they kind of cultivate this culture of leadership amongst those students to help network out to other students. They also did honor fraternities for African-American and Latino students. And so they found, again, low-cost ways to really value what students were doing and bringing, and then bringing those student voices into the conversation and by really helping them develop a leadership role.
I was wondering, you mentioned that providing additional hours for advising outside the classroom helped with students and really catering to what their academic schedules looked like. I was wondering if there was any conversation, what that looked like, about enhancing the student experience within the classroom and seeing how those students, if they felt marginalized in the classroom, and what the faculty side of things looked like.
Mm-hmm. Well, Florida State, we talk with a number of institutions and have other institutions we've worked with. Florida State came at it primarily from a student support angle. But what we find on a number of institutions is, in many ways, there's such a strong faculty presence that they really wanted it to be central to what was happening in the classroom, particularly if you're an institution that has a lot of commuters. Frequently, and we've heard this term used before, PCPs, parking lot, classroom, parking lot. So for some students, the only way they experience the campus is in the classroom with that individual faculty member. And so other institutions, not so much Florida State, but other institutions have really focused on what does high impact learning look like in the classroom? What are the kinds of collaborative, teaching strategies that we need to do to make sure that we're engaging, in particular, our low-income, first-generation minority students. There's a lot of research by George Koo on how high-impact practices, undergraduate research, collaborative learning, those are all strategies that actually have a disproportionately high impact on the learning outcomes for those populations. So University of Wisconsin-Eau Claire has done a lot of work in that area, as well as San Diego State.
Can you explain the steps?
So this is just their first year retention rate over time, and then each of those is one of the major reforms that they put into place. And they had a lot of smaller reforms that they put into place as well, but that corresponds with when they started each of those reforms.
How does the first year experience and sophomore experience play a role in your retention at Florida State?
So they have a lot of data. I would definitely encourage reaching out to them. They've been very systematic about evaluating those efforts, and so they have data on their orientation program, on their living learning communities, on their freshman interest groups. So they've got a lot of what you'd expect to be kind of the typical first year programs, but they do really rigorously evaluate. They find that those programs all boost retention somewhere between 5 and 7 percentage points. And to the extent that they can make those mandatory, they've done that as well, because they find that when it's not mandatory, it can be difficult for first generation students in particular to know, A, why is that important to me, and what is it, and why is it important to me? But also, until you make it mandatory, you don't often think about what are the barriers that we don't realize for students to take advantages of the services that we're offering. And I think that's a key piece of this as well, is that, for instance, we see in the research that low-income students typically come to the very last orientation session that you offer, say, in the summer, because they can't afford to take time off work and to travel, particularly if they're coming from out of town, to come, to one of the earlier orientation sessions. But then they miss out on all the good classes. They miss out on the opportunity to take their placement test early enough in the summer that they could take a course at their local community college and fill that need. They miss out on the best housing. And so, there are real barriers even when there doesn't appear to be, but when you make those services mandatory, that discussion needs to be had, because you need to think about if you're going to make it mandatory, how are you going to remove barriers for low-income students in particular to take advantage of them?
Question about the student contract. What information is in that? Is it followed up with later on during the coaching session or anything
after? I don't know. I don't have additional details on kind of what the nature of that looks like, except that, again, it does have that trigger in terms of making sure that students do connect with their advisor if they go off the map, and because of the action steps that they have in place, when students have, a dip in their grade point average or other issues that come up, there is someone who personally has to contact that student and say, we need to talk about this. So if you go to College Results Online, almost all of the data points that you mentioned there are available, and you can make comparisons between schools on that basis. First generation status is not collected in IPEDS, so we're not able to look at that. Low income graduation rates and transfer graduation rates are not collected in IPEDS, so we rely on the institutions themselves when we have those data available. But almost every one of those data points is available. When we do, because we've got a series of publications where we've tried to identify institutions that have made strong gains in graduation rates for minority students or in narrowing graduation rate gaps, and we always look at, we exclude institutions where the diversity of their incoming class has gone down, because we know that for many institutions, you know, they feel that the quickest way to get better, you know, there's an easier way, I suppose, of doing this work in terms of becoming more selective and more exclusive, but that really runs counter to the public mission of so many of our universities, and it runs counter to the larger, you know, national goal that we have and the need that we have to better educate low-income and underrepresented minority students. And so, the quick way, the easy way, if you will, as it is in terms of the data, we don't want to highlight institutions that have made gains as a result of becoming more exclusive or more selective.
What's the advisor-to-student ratio like?
You know, I don't know that offhand. I do know that a big part of their strategy was they had advisors in each of the departments, but then they also developed this advising core that they hired and cross-trained centrally, and that was a big piece of their advising strategy as well. So I don't know the ratio, but they did have, in addition to the departmental advisors, they had this cross-trained core that really was focused on advising as its primary goal. They also have since started doing coaching, so they've got some coaching pilots where these are folks who are trained to contact students and talk about the non-academic issues that might be affecting them, and they've seen some good results with their coaching program as well.
Was the data on graduation rates disaggregated based upon STEM versus non-STEM majors?
So we don't have that data nationally either. Unfortunately, IPEDS does tell us what percentage of degrees are conferred in different areas, but they don't give us graduation rates by majors. So we're not able to look at that from our vantage point, but institutions could. I don't know that they did at Florida State. But we know that some of the other institutions, because particularly an institution like Stony Brook or like Florida State or Georgia State, you know, they are large institutions, and so there's a lot of work that needs to happen at the departmental level to really make these efforts successful as well. And so at Georgia State, they actually did a lot of work beyond that first 2 years to make sure that data were accessible to department chairs and deans so that they were looking at the success of their particular majors over time. They also did a lot of work to make sure that department chairs and deans knew what the success rates were for students in particularly those introductory courses, which can become gatekeepers in a lot of ways, so wanted them to know what their DFW rates were in the courses that fell, you know, within their department, so they could start to figure out what are the strategies that we need to boost rates, because those are courses that really take out a lot of students early on. Yeah, we've not looked in particular at the issue of STEM or at the issue of gender, but I think that there's certainly, you know, it's suggested from the national data that the gap that we see for low-income and underrepresented minority students is in part a gender gap. So we do know, and there has been a big focus on, you know, young males of color and from modest means, because there is, in particular, a need for that population. There's another question here. Well, I mean, I think we know that literature pretty well, you know, and I think we're going to hear a little bit about that, at least, you know, in the Stony Brook context, you know, what are the specific issues that our students bring and how do we need to focus on those? So I think we'll hear a little bit about that later. You know, what I think it's important for us to keep in mind is what do we as an institution need to do to make sure that students are successful regardless of what they bring with them, because we've admitted them as an institution and we've signaled that they can and should be able to succeed here. So thinking about not only what do we need to help students, but what do we need to do on the institution side to make sure we're not creating barriers that we may not be aware that exist, like sitting down with your course catalog and trying to figure it out. It's more of a life coaching, you know, so they, and it's pretty light in terms of the intervention. I think they talk with students 15 minutes a week, and then it, you know, stretches out to fewer times over the semester, but really it's that it's about that contact, and it's about what it signals to the student about someone cares, someone's calling, that they actually have seen some pretty impressive gains.
So was the coaching program kind of like what you would consider as like a mentoring program where they would get connected, or would one person speaking to a group of students?
It was one person speaking to a number of students. And there's actually a professional company that does this, and I can't remember their name at the moment, but they're very expensive. And so Florida State did it for a little while with them and then decided to do it themselves. So don't tell them I said that. But it was, you know, a professionally trained coach who would reach out to and had a portfolio of students and maintain that connection. But it was primarily by phone and email. Yeah. Other questions? Oh, one more.
You talked about the need to sort of elevate what's going on campus as a whole and then have some pillars for different groups. Can you talk a little bit more about what you mean by that? Is that for the underrepresented groups, or is it for the freshman to sophomore group, or all of the above?
Well, I think, you know, what was instructive about Florida State was that they looked at their data in part to figure out who are the subgroups of students that we need to support. And they looked at their data in a number of different ways. And so I think, you know, the best way to answer that question would be to look at your data and see where are the transition points, where our students seem to be having trouble, which students are the ones who seem to be having trouble at that transition point. Is it all students? Is it particular students? You know, they tell a story as well about, you know, they saw that female, Hispanic, low-income students also had a very jumpy kind of retention table when you looked at it. And what they found out by sitting down, they did focus groups with students. So they'd often look at the data. They'd sit down with students, try to figure out what's going on. And they found out that a number of students were actually trying to go home a lot and, you know, going back to the cities. And they were having a difficult time getting back on campus. They were relied on to really come help when there were family issues. And so they basically, and again, this was no cost to the university, they just designed some space to have this bus run, you know, to the cities every single weekend, Friday night, back on Monday morning. So again, there are just strategies that were very, those kind of pillars of support were really designed about what did the data tell them and what did the students tell them were really necessary to get them over those barriers to being successful. Okay, thank you all so much.
Thank you, everyone, for their engaging with Dr. Engle on her talk. It's clear that we have much to think about here. But right now, we're going to take a break so you can digest what you've taken in from Dr. Engle and have some more bagels, coffee. We'll change the stage. And it's we're right on track. It's 10 past 10, so in 15 minutes, please return and we'll have the SED students remind you. Okay, see you in 15 minutes. Hello, everyone. Let's take our seats and so that we may begin for the next part of our program. Okay, so this part of the program involves hearing from respondents and from our students, and each of our panelists has been selected for their extraordinary service to this university and expertise relating to today's topic. And each provides a different glimpse into our efforts to reach and to serve low-income students. And so I'm going to introduce Dr. David Bynum and Assistant Provost Cheryl Hamilton and the students all at once so that we, the rest of the program, can move forward. And then we'll take questions after the students have presented. So David Bynum is professor at biochemistry and cell biology. He joined Stony Brook University in 1982. And by 1995, he had founded the Center for Science and Mathematics Education, which operates under the Long Island Group's Advancing Science Education. In his role as director, he's received over $20 million in external funding to promote science education. And besides being recognized by our own Chancellor's Award for Excellence in Faculty Service and the President's Award for Excellence in Diversity and Affirmative Action, Dr. Bynum is nationally recognized for transforming biology education through hands-on research and developing programs to provide research opportunities to underrepresented students. His successes recently won him the coveted Bruce Alberts Award from the American Society for Cell Biology, as well as the prestigious Presidential Award for Excellence in Science. He was one of 10 scholars awarded for having increased participation in the sciences of women, members of minority groups, and students with disabilities. Dr. Bynum's innovation and energetic passion to provide education and research opportunities for students who might not otherwise have the opportunity to experience the excitement and wonder of science and math make him a perfect respondent to Dr. Engle's presentation. Likewise, Cheryl Hamilton, the Assistant Provost for Educational Opportunity and Director of the Educational Opportunity Program, known to us here at Stony Brook as AIM, the Advancement on Individual Merit Program. Since 1994, in this role as director, Cheryl is an essential part of today's topic. The graduation rates for EOP AIM have received national attention. In October 2010, PBS NewsHour highlighted the work achieved under Cheryl's leadership, and that video is available on our website. This program noted that we graduate 65% of our Latino students and 70% of our African American students. We know that the success rate of our EOP AIM program contributes to our success, and its programs targeting low-income students have provided what is needed. Dr. Engle referred to the quote, strategies that work for first-generation and low-income students are likely to be successful for the general population as well. We have much to learn from our EOP AIM program and for the leadership provided by Assistant Provost Hamilton. Now our student panel were chosen to help us consider the real-life experiences of achieving success and attempting to succeed here at Stony Brook University. Dr. Engle's work challenges researchers to examine paths forward from achievement and success. We therefore gathered three successful students who have managed to find paths towards extraordinary achievement. We appreciate their willingness to join us this morning. We have Pierre Albert, who is a senior in political science. He's in the accelerated BA/MA program in public policy and anticipates graduating from this program next May. Pierre is a member of our EOP AIM program. He was elected president of the EOP Student Association in 2009 and served in this capacity for 2 years. At the same time, in 2009, he was elected to serve as president of Stony Brook University's Student African American Brotherhood. He currently continues to serve in this capacity. In addition, he works on campus within campus residences as a residential assistant at the Stoller Center, within our Student Activities Center office, and within the EOP Summer Academy as a philosophy peer advisor tutor. As Pierre moves toward the challenges of graduate studies, he will receive a Burkhardt Turner Fellowship. Pierre's home is in Brooklyn, New York. Diana Lennis is a transfer student from SUNY Old Westbury and now a senior in biochemistry. Diana was a recipient of the prestigious Howard Hughes Medical Institute Fellowship during the summer of 2011. The department's website states that only the stronger students are awarded this fellowship. Diana was placed within the laboratory of Dr. Joan Stites at Yale in the Department of Molecular Biophysics and Biochemistry. She is also a recipient of the Minority Access to Research Careers Fellowship, and while at SUNY Old Westbury, she received the Achievement in Community Engagement Scholarship. She took part in Stony Brook's study abroad program in Argentina, and she participated in the Public Health Global Brigades in Honduras. Diana currently works within the Stephen Baines Laboratory of Aquatic Ecosystem Ecology, and her home is in Bethpage. And of course, Paris Tyson. Paris is a senior within our School of Social Welfare. She is currently completing her field education internship hours at St. Charles Hospital in Port Jefferson, working within the social work department there. In addition to her full-time status, she also has worked on campus in the Student Activities Office and is a research associate for the Liberty Partnership Program. Her leadership capabilities have been utilized as treasurer and now president of Stony Brook's Black Women's Weekend. Paris's home is in Bayshore, Long Island. Each of these students have a powerful story to relate, and they will immediately follow our respondents. So we're going to begin, and Dr. Bynum has agreed to start. Please welcome Dr. Bynum.
Thank you. Well, it's a pleasure to be here. I really thank the School of Social Welfare for putting on this leadership symposium. It's great for Dr. Engle to come here, and I really enjoyed her talk. I can't wait to talk to her later and ask her some more questions. And it's always a pleasure to present with Cheryl because I've known her for over a decade, admired her work for a long time, and it's one of the many reasons that Stony Brook is a special place. What we've done here in the last decade, we've created a Center for Science and Math Education, but along with that, there have been a lot of cultural changes in the university. So I'm going to talk a little bit about both of those things. But I thought I'd begin at the beginning. We started in 1957. The university is very young. We began at Oyster Bay, New York, started out as a teaching college. Immediately after that, Sputnik went up. The political view of the world changed, and the view of what Stony Brook should be changed, and we rapidly became a major research and graduate institution, somewhat to the neglect of undergraduate education and teacher education. In fact, the School of Education was retrenched, closed down in the 70s. And then in the 80s, when I came, things were kind of foul. Teacher education, undergraduate education, student paying attention to students was not, it was done, but it wasn't done nearly with the extent that it's done now. So then I'll kind of come on the scenes in the 90s. In 1992, I was looking for some way to provide opportunities to students. And a colleague suggested, she said, you know, why don't you write a grant? I knew you know, I'd been in business, and I knew you needed money to do things. And so I said, that's a great idea. What should I do? And she suggested writing NIH Bridges to the Baccalaureate grant. And I got the guy you can talk to. It's David Ferguson over in Tech and Society. And I went over to talk to David, and that changed my life. And I consider, David had been doing this kind of thing for several years prior, told him what I wanted to do, write a grant to connect Nassau, Suffolk, and Queensborough Community Colleges to Stony Brook, bring their students here to carry out research, and see if we could attract them into research fields. That started a collaboration with David and myself that lasted a decade. He's been totally instrumental. I chose the right guy to work with because a few years later he went to the White House to receive a national award. And every grant that we wrote, I passed by David and we talked it over and worked on before we moved forward. So, you know, you need people like that to get started. And David was really instrumental to me. So we wrote that grant. We got it. We developed a six-week summer program. Didn't quite know what we were doing, but the students were really excited in the lab. And they came to us and they said, we'd like to come back in the evening and work at the labs. And I'd never seen this before. They were being paid a salary, but they were designing research projects, but they wanted to come back and work more. So we opened the lab in the evening, and I went over and I told my chair, I said, who's Bill Lenartz, who is also very instrumental in our doing all of these things. He came over and saw it. He said, my gosh, this is the way to do things. We had a new president, President Shirley Strum Kinney. He notified her, and she got interested in it, and that was really a key. For the next decade, she came to our ceremonies. She was a great fan of our programs and really got us off and running. So that grant is still going on, by the way, Bridges to the Baccalaureate. It's being run by Daniel Maloney. We have community college students coming in again this summer. It's been a 19-year program. So in 1994, 2 years later, I had a chance to write a grant to the Howard Hughes Medical Institute to do similar things for our students, provide research opportunities, connect with high-needs schools, and design new courses. We wrote that. We were successful. And we've taken that grant over the last 18 years and really built it out and opened up opportunities from pre-K to postdoc all along the gradient of education and also in biology, chemistry, physics, earth sciences, and mathematics. We now have a center that's pretty comprehensive. And the Hughes has supported us for 18 years. I have their hat. I wear it all the time because they've been very supportive of us. And it's really meant a great deal. It also allowed us to work with the administration because the administration would match a lot of the funding that we got from the Hughes folks and support what we were doing. So it's that part has really been a great run. In 95, we wrote and got an NSF Advanced Technological Education grant, and that's where we named our group LIGACE, Long Island Group Advancing Science Education. We set our motto as provide opportunity for everybody who's willing to learn, and we built out we built labs in community colleges and some high-need schools, and we started developing some courses for teachers. In 1998, we received an NIH Minority Access to Research Careers Award, an award that we still have, again directed by Dr. Maloney. And we heard Diana Linus being mentioned. She had one of those awards. That's been a great grant because it encourages juniors and seniors to go on and get their doctorate, provides excellent financial support. And we've had about 100 students coming in, and now we have about 60% of the students who come in and receive that award go off to graduate school. So it's been very productive for us to have that. So we, in 2000, I read there was a report in the ASBMB, American Society for Biochemistry and Molecular Biology, and it said Stony Brook was number one in the country at graduating underrepresented students in biochemistry, and UMBC, University of Maryland, Baltimore County, was second. And I know how good they are, so I said, wow, that's great. So a bunch of us got in an airplane and went down and visited UMBC to see why they were so good, and we found out why. I mean, they're really good. I mean, they're a model. They have money for students. They have Meyerhoff fellowships. They have their top faculty is geared into providing opportunity for students. They have aggressive recruitment, and they have great support services for students, and they have fabulous leadership. Their president Freeman Hrabowski, I mean, he's nationally known. We walked across. He's so impressive to be around. He just catalyzes things happening all the time. But I remember walking across campus with him, and he was, of course, carrying on. All of a sudden, he said, "Excuse me," and he goes over and starts talking to an undergraduate, and he talks to him in detail about his life, what he's taking, what he's doing, and so forth. And I was so struck that a man of that leadership, that high up, would take the time out to do that kind of thing. It never left me, and you know, I try to remember when I think about how one should handle those kinds of situations. So anyhow, what came of that? A couple of years, we came back. A year or two later, the Center for Inclusive Education was formed here. David Ferguson again leads that. Nina Mong, who I saw earlier, directs the center now. And Freeman came up and did the dedication service. So that's ongoing now. Lawrence Martin, the former dean of the graduate school, was very instrumental in that. So in 2003, we started getting involved in teacher education. Excuse me, and we got a small amount of money from the NSF, and we went around we wanted to promote teachers going into high-need schools. Went around and asked all the administrators at Stony Brook to match that gift. Turns out that everybody did. The dean at that time, Lawrence Martin, awarded us 14 tuition waivers, and we developed 14 fellowships for teachers to go into high-need schools and do their student teaching. And that really convinced me when I saw our own leadership step up like that. They didn't have to do this, and money is not that easy to come by. They were supportive of these kind of activities. You knew you were at a special place when you could get that kind of reaction. So then a year later, we were made responsible for all the teaching programs, the STEM teaching, or the science teaching programs here at Stony Brook, biology, chemistry, physics, and earth sciences. We have a gentleman leading those now who's a faculty member in the Department of Biochemistry. We graduate about 50 students a year. We place them in schools all over Long Island and in the city. The fellow that leads that effort, Keith Shepherd, has over $1 million in fellowships. If you want to teach in a high-need school, you can get NSF Noise Fellowships. If you want to teach in the city, we have a Petrie Fellowship, so one can go teach. And we really have put a lot of teachers into these schools. For example, Brentwood, which is a large high-need school, but a great school, and we know it very well. We put 22 teachers, science and math teachers in there in the last decade. Once you start to put those kind of numbers in a school, you really have an impact, and Stony Brook is having a major impact. So when in 2007, the provost did make us a center, the Center for Science and Math Education, so now we're involved both in mathematics and sciences. And Joan Kiley, who's a faculty member in our center, runs a part of that, the biotechnology teaching laboratories, and where we bring in students from all around Long Island and in New York City. We have a whole class coming in from New York City next month to work in the lab for a half a day to do hands-on molecular biology activities that are mandated by the state but difficult to do in the schools. And over the last, since we've been doing this, we've had over 50,000 students come in, work in these labs. We've evaluated, the students love it, their interest goes up, their desire to carry it out as a career. And one of the nice things we do, again, off of the Hughes grant for the high need schools, we waive the fee. There's a $20 fee to do this, but we're able to support schools where that might be more of a challenge. In 2011, we recruited one more faculty member, Angela Kelly, who's also a faculty member in the Department of Physics, and her research involves access to science courses from low-income students, especially in New York City. She's been here for 4 or 5 months. She's already submitted 2 major grants to support her research, and we're really excited to see the contribution she's going to make here. So, we've been doing this now for almost 2 decades. We've made available several $1 million in fellowships for underrepresented and high-need students. We've provided hundreds of research opportunities. We mentor and advise these students. We built partnerships with the Long Island, almost all the Long Island schools, but put an emphasis on the high-need schools. We run summer programs in many of those schools, and we have fellowships for students who want to teach in those schools. Now, our center is only one thing here, and it's, I think it's special, but everybody thinks what they do is special. But there are many other activities going on here at Stony Brook that are just like this. If you look over again at David Ferguson, there's, and Paul Siegel, who directs Smart STEM, they've, again, brought in millions of dollars, much of it in NSF funding. I'm directly involved in one of the proposals to support students, doing wonderful work over there. Insofar as looking at the curriculum, Dave Hansen and Troy Wolfskill have redone the chemistry curriculum to make it more accessible to students who haven't gotten an outstanding chemistry preparation when they were in high school. And if you look at what's going on in biology, our director of undergraduate biology education, Peter Gergen, and Marvin O'Neill are carrying out similar activities in biology. So we're really working to make the curriculum more accessible and more open to students. There are many others. Karen Kernan, who runs Eureka, we work closely with her. We sponsor the undergraduate celebration of research every year with her. A great program. There's Carrie Ann Miller, who in the WISE program, which has been here for 15 years and fabulous. And I guess the last person I'd mention is Judy Verhanen, because Judy, who's our director of admissions, because she was there from the start. When we very first started that program back in 1993, Judy helped us design it when we didn't know what we were doing, mentored the students. She's still doing the same thing today, comes over and talks and counsels them through the program. It's these long-term positive relations that really count when you're building these kind of things. So, lots of time, I talk to students all the time. I really enjoy it, and I've had a very interesting life by my standards. I didn't take my first biology course till I was 31, and like Dr. Engle, I was the first one in my family to graduate. I grew up in Oklahoma, first one to graduate from college, so it's really made my life a lot of fun. But I tell students, if they want to make their life last a long time, find some work that you don't enjoy. But for me, my life has gone by like a blur, but it really still feels like I'm only at the beginning. Thank you.
Okay, Cheryl, come on up to the stage. Dr. Bynum, thank you very much for, and it's an example of continuous and ongoing involvement from the university to the community and the community back. Cheryl, we're looking forward to you.
I think we should certainly start by giving another hand to Dr. Bynum for all of the work that he does. I'm always amazed at the types of work that take place right here on our campus, and I was thoroughly impressed with Dr. Engle's presentation in terms of the types of things that are going on other campuses to support our low-income and first-generation college students. And so I'm going to talk very briefly as I possibly can, about the types of support that we provide through the Educational Opportunity Program here at Stony Brook to increase the likelihood of success of our low-income and first-generation college students. But I also want to spend a little bit of time talking about the challenges. And so to begin, let me please explain to you the purpose and the mission of the Educational Opportunity Program. And I've provided the definition here, but in short, our program aims to provide access and opportunity to higher education for New York State students who by the state standards are considered economically disadvantaged, which means that our students fall within certain income guidelines, and by the university standards are considered academically disadvantaged, which means that students coming into the university through EOP are actually students who fall short of the criteria for general admission. These are students who otherwise would not be eligible for admission to the university were it not for the program. And so the program aims to facilitate the recruitment, the enrollment, the retention, and ultimately the graduation of these students. So I want to begin by giving a side-by-side comparison of the first-time full-time EOP students versus the first-time full-time non-EOP students coming into the university. And you're going to see certainly when we look at the middle 50% in terms of SAT scores, we're talking about students who are coming in significantly underprepared when you look at their peers. We're looking at SAT scores of 250 points or higher, lower than the students who are coming in through general admission. We see that there are certainly differences in terms of high school average, not as significant, but I want to point out that many of the students who we're bringing in through EOP are students who are coming in from under-resourced high schools. So these are schools that might not have AP courses, might not have strong college preparatory curriculum, might not necessarily have updated textbooks. And I could go on in terms of what our students are not getting. So our program has basically the responsibility of bridging the gap between what our students got in high school and what they really need to be successful at a university such as Stony Brook. So certainly we start out with some academic challenges. And we know, I've been at the university for almost 18 years, believe it or not. I started when I was 5. In the time that I've been here, we've seen a steady increase in the minimum SAT scores and the minimum high school average of students coming into the university. EOP maintains its commitment to access. And as such, we have not raised the minimum SAT for students coming in through EOP, nor have we raised the minimum high school average. So what's happening is we're seeing an increasing gap between the level of preparation of students coming in through general admission and the level of preparation of students coming in through EOP. We're also seeing a wider range of students because while we haven't raised the minimum, we've had to raise the maximum because, again, the program attracts students who are not eligible for general admission to the university. So we are in a position where we have to provide support to a wider range of students. So it really means as a program, we have to work smarter because we are committed to bringing these students in and making sure that they're successful here and that they graduate. Another challenge that I will point out with going into detail, some of us had an opportunity to listen to our Chancellor's State of the University address where she talked about the fact that we don't really need remediation in SUNY. We don't need developmental courses. But again, if we know that we have students who are coming in with deficiencies, something needs to happen to bridge the gap between what our students come in with and what they really need to be successful. I want to also talk about our students in terms of being economically disadvantaged, and I believe it was already said that at Stony Brook, we serve a large percentage of low-income students. Somewhere near one-third of the students coming in through the university are actually Pell eligible. But I would argue that students coming in through EOP are students who are at that very bottom of the Pell eligible group. Looking at our fall 2011 entering class, the average gross family income for that group was over $86,000. Comparatively, when we look at the average gross family income of our EOP dependent students, We're talking about a family income of $18,000. These are students who are coming primarily from Long Island and from New York City. So imagine living on Long Island or New York City, supporting your whole family on $18,000. So we're talking about not a lot of excess money for things like SAT prep courses, tutoring, other resources that our students really need to be academically successful. In terms of their estimated family contribution, we're talking about an estimated family contribution of zero. So families are not able to come up with money to purchase books and supplies and those kinds of things that our students need to be successful. Again, our students are characterized, their families are characterized by having very little or no accumulation of assets. So it's not like they can borrow against the house to help pay for college. That can't happen with our students. They're not going to sell the second car so they can help to pay for their college bills. It just can't happen. And again, our students are largely first-generation college students. Again, just for clarification, I've provided a breakdown in terms of the maximum family income for students coming in through EOP. So again, we talk about a set of economic challenges. Certainly, in comparison to our other AAU institutions, Stony Brook is certainly affordable. But at the same time, we are seeing increases in tuition, in fees, in room and board. And unfortunately, the grant aid that our students receive, the Pell Grants, the TAP, the SEOG, these awards are not increasing to meet the needs of our students. So what happens is that we have students who end up having to take two or three loans just to pay the full cost of attending the university. I know that when Pierre was being introduced, I think Gene mentioned three jobs that he's working. We have students who are often working multiple jobs just to help to pay their basic expenses, and that happens at the expense of their academic performance. I want to mention also that we are seeing an increase in the number of students who are commuting to the campus, sometimes from as far away as New York City. I know that we had a freshman this year who commuted every day from Brooklyn. He had classes 5 days a week, commuted from Brooklyn. I'm certainly happy to report that the student actually got a 4.0 GPA, but I don't know how he did it. So our students certainly face some challenges, and I want to point out that there are also some non-financial risk factors that are common in this student population. Simply because of low socioeconomic status, we have students who are dealing with family obligations and certainly come in with the lack of experience on a college campus. So when I sit in meetings and I bear in mind all of the needs of this student population and I listen to my colleagues saying there needs to be consistency in service, can't we just provide the same services for EOP that we provide for everybody else? We're not talking about students with the same sets of needs. And I see that I have a slide in common with Dr. Engle in terms of strategies for working with the student population. And basically, back in 2000, Paul Thayer basically said that you can certainly take the strategies that we use for low-income and first-generation college students and apply this to the general student population. And in all likelihood, everyone's going to be successful. That's going to work. But if you try to take the services that are already available for everybody else without taking into account the special needs of this student population, chances are our student population is not likely to be successful. So as I talk about the additional challenges that we face as a program, I want you to look at them through this lens. So this is what the theorists say. So we know that Tinto says back in 2003 that it's important that we provide early intervention, that we create a supportive academic and social environment. This is something that I know that Stony Brook does very well. Q said back in 2005 that it's important that we build a culture of success, that we monitor student progress, that we provide proactive advising and counseling. A main component of our program is tutoring and supplemental instruction. Pasquarella and Terenzini assert that this is something that makes a huge difference in terms of making sure that our student population is successful. It's important also that we have faculty and staff that are committed to student success. And of course, from the Pell Institute, we learned that it's important to have very strong leadership and supportive leadership from the top, and I feel like Stony Brook has that. So a lot of bullets here. I know that I have limited time. So I want to again mention some of the strengths in terms of early intervention and supportive academic and social environment. One of the things that I believe Stony Brook and EOP does well, we offer a 5-week pre-freshman summer academy for all of our students coming in through EOP. In fact, their admission to the university is contingent upon successful completion of this program. And it becomes almost a university-wide program. As I look around the room, almost everybody in this room has some involvement with that summer academy. This becomes the university's summer academy. And we bring the students in, and the students have an opportunity to meet with faculty and with some of our top leaders at the university. But more important, it's an opportunity for us to help bridge the gap between what they got in high school and what they really need to be successful here at the university. So in terms of early intervention, this is key. Something else that EOP has been doing for a long time, almost for as long as I've been here, is that we offer a mandatory first-year seminar for all of our EOP students. I believe we were actually the first program, this predates the undergraduate colleges, so we were actually the first program on campus to mandate that all of our students coming in take this. It used to be USB 101, and then it became SBU 101, and now it's undergraduate colleges 101. But we had special sections that were taught by EOP counselors. And the nice thing about these seminars is that this was an opportunity to work with our students and to help to bridge their home communities and the academic communities. This is key when we're working with first generation and low income college students. It was also an opportunity to address the unique needs of this student population. And while the program continues to teach these sections, we're now integrating our students into the undergraduate colleges. And I think this is certainly not a slight to the undergraduate colleges, because I think they're fantastic. They work well for our students. They work well for all students. But the challenge with us is that bringing our students into, say, the SSO 101 courses, there is a set curriculum for SSO 101. So my advisor who teaches SSO 101 has to take a look at that curriculum and say, well, you know, we're not meeting for 15 weeks, we're meeting for 12 weeks, so what can I not do? Can I not talk about financial aid so I make sure that I bring this in? Can I not talk about the social adjustments? So again, it means that we have to work differently, and we have to think of other ways of making sure that this information is provided to our students, often outside of the undergraduate colleges and outside of our 101. We know that it's important that we create a culture of success. I think the university does this well. I think that the program does this well. For our students coming in through EOP, we communicate that we have very high expectations, but we provide a very high level of support. Our expectations are way up there. We're expecting that every student who comes in through our program is going to graduate, but then we provide the tools that they need in order to do so. One of the things that sets us apart from many of our fellow institutions is that students coming in through EOP at Stony Brook have a very strong sense of pride in the program. I've been on campuses where there's a stigma attached to being part of an opportunity program. Here, students take a lot of pride in the program because they know when they come in through this program, they're going to be successful and they're going to get the tools that they need to succeed. I want to talk a little bit about the monitoring of students and providing proactive advising. So Dr. Engle talked about the mapping that takes place. And one of the things that our counselors do very well, our EOP advisors, we sit down with each student individually at least once each semester. They're required to attend 3 mandatory meetings each semester with their assigned advisors. We use a caseload model. All of our students have an assigned advisor who works with them throughout their 4 or 5 years at the university. And the advisors actually develop individualized academic plans with each student. So it's an opportunity to look at, based on their academic plans, when they're going to take their major requirements, when they're going to take their DEC requirements, how does a minor fit in there? And if they're going to do an internship, or if they're planning to take their MCATs or their LSATs, where does all of that fit in? This is key. One of the other things that we do as a program, and I know that my colleagues find this slightly amusing, we have a registration block on our students at all times. So our students can't register without seeing their advisors. They can't drop a class. They can't add a class. They can't PNC. They can't withdraw without meeting with an advisor, because we want to make sure that they are staying true to this academic plan. So in theory, this works really well, right? So here are the challenges. One of the challenges, and this is not unique to EOP, one of the challenges is course availability. So our advisors will sit down and painstakingly plan academic plans with each student, and then they go to register, and then there's the challenge that the course that they hoped they could take is not being offered this semester because, I don't know, the department couldn't. So therefore, they've got to find the money to take it in the summer, they've got to take it during winter session, which, by the way, there's no financial aid for. So these are some of the challenges that our students face. Here's another challenge. So historically, advising for EOP students meant, and registration for EOP students meant, sitting down with an advisor and having a one-on-one session with their advisor. They would look at the courses that were planned, the advisor would go in and put them in their classes, the block would go back on, and they would go on with their day, done. So an interesting thing, this was able to happen because we had priority registration by a couple of days. We enjoyed the same type of priority registration that's afforded now to student athletes. Of 2 days, not a lot. We now have priority registration by 2 hours. 2 hours. And guess what time registration starts? It's 7 o'clock in the morning. So our EOP students have the privilege of being able to register at 7 o'clock in the morning, 2 hours before their peers. However, I can't ask my advisors to come in at 7 o'clock in the morning to register their students. So what happens is that our advisors have to remove the block, hope and pray that our freshman students don't register for biology, chemistry, physics, and calculus in a semester, and then go back probably 2 or 3 days later, put the block back on, if in fact they did register for the classes that we hoped. So again, some challenges just in terms of policy and procedure. Another challenge, and this falls within our program, is the need to monitor student performance data and respond to it. And as a program, this is something that we can certainly do better. There are trends. We do see that there are semesters when we see more freshmen who are ending up on academic warning, or more students who are struggling with chemistry or with calculus. And as a program, something that we can certainly do better is take a look at that data and try to figure out why that's happening and respond to that data. So in terms of challenges, that's something that we can certainly do better. I want to talk also about tutoring and supplemental instruction, because this is key to our program. And one of the nice things about EOP is that we are able to offer a comprehensive tutorial program. This program is mandated by New York State because of the student population that we serve, and it's funded by New York State because of the population that we serve. The nice thing is that we're able to provide both individual and group tutoring to our students. We provide supplemental instruction to our students. The challenge, however, is that we don't have a dedicated space to offer that tutoring. So we have this nice budget, we've got these great tutors that we spend a lot of time training and preparing to work with our student population, but because we don't have a dedicated space, we say, okay, these are your students, we're going to send you to a remote classroom where you can tutor, and we hope you're doing that, and just give us your sign-in sheets, and we're just going to hope that's happening. When in fact, the other university centers within SUNY all have a dedicated tutorial space for EOP. Another strength of our university is that we do have faculty and staff that are committed to student learning, and I think that speaks to the university culture. We have people like Dr. Bynum and many of the faculty members in this room who are sincerely committed to seeing our students succeed, and that really makes a difference for our students. We have people who care. We have faculty members who are willing to go above and beyond to make sure that all of our students' needs are met. In terms of our program, we have campus-wide involvement in the program. Even in terms of senior leadership, one of the strengths of our program, again, is that senior leadership of this university is actually involved in orienting our EOP students to the campus. It is not unusual during our summer academy for Dr. Bajant to come over to have dinner with our students, for Dr. Robbins to come over and meet with the students, even President Stanley and his wife spend a lot of time with our students during the summer. However, there are challenges. There's a small number of faculty members, not many, but there are people who don't really understand our student population. And there are people, and I know because I've heard them say this in committee meetings, I'm on committees with them, who will say that students who are underprepared don't belong at this university. And just imagine if there's a faculty member who believes that, and you're a student in that class. Our students are sharp. You think our students don't pick up on that? They can feel that. How do you think a student is going to feel in a class with a faculty member who doesn't necessarily believe that they belong there? Another myth, strangely, is that people seem to believe that EOP students, because they are coming in underprepared, because they are first-generation college students, and because they are lower-income students, that they are actually dragging down the graduation rates of the university, when actually the reverse is true. EOP is helping to raise the graduation rates and the retention rates at Stony Brook. And so I've provided some data, just in terms of four of our classes, from 2000 to 2003, in terms of the EOP graduation rate and the Stony Brook University graduation rate. We see that the graduation rate of EOP actually exceeds that of the general student population anywhere from 7% to 15%. All of this in spite of the fact that these are students who are really coming in underprepared. I've already talked about strong commitment from top leadership. Again, top leadership is very much involved in our program on so many levels. But in terms of challenges, and this is a university-wide concern, we really need to do a better job of analyzing what works and what doesn't work. We need to build on the strengths. We know that there are strengths in terms of meeting this student population. We need to build on that. We know that there are barriers, and as a program, as a university, I feel like we have an obligation to eliminate those barriers. Again, it's important as we institute new university-wide policies that we take into consideration the special needs and the special circumstances of our low-income students and our first-generation college students. And I just want to close by saying that when we are intentional about fostering persistence and degree attainment for our most vulnerable, low-income, and first-generation college students, it's really a win-win for the entire university. We're putting ourselves as a university in a position that we're increasing the overall graduation rates and thereby increasing the entire profile of the university. Thank you.
There is much to learn from Cheryl's program and her leadership. And so now we've heard from two extraordinary efforts here at this university, but now it's time to understand more clearly what the experience of our students are having in finding their path through this university. What the students and I have agreed is that they're going to speak from the table, sitting down. They're not going to speak each one and then another and another, but we will have a conversation between myself and the three students around the questions that they've been asked to consider. Right? That's what we agreed, right? So. I'm going to ask for this, if we could pass one of the mics down so that our three students don't have to share the one. And actually, I think this doesn't seem to be on. Okay.
Thank you.
So what we've asked the students to consider is that we know that you're successful and that there are many things that have contributed to your success. But we're interested in how you might identify what was most important to you in reflecting back on how you've managed to achieve what you have here at Stony Brook. And Pierre, you agreed to start us off.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Let me just say that I'm happy to be here this morning. And Cheryl gave an awesome presentation and is like extremely hard to follow up, but I'm going to try. As it relates to the question about what has contributed to my success the most, I would have to say the first thing that comes to my mind, and it's not just because Cheryl just spoke, but it's just been the EOP program. And everywhere I go and I say that I'm an EOP student, and I'm proud to say that I'm an EOP student, it's nothing to be embarrassed about. But just to touch upon one specific point in answering the question, when I walked in, Cheryl, the first thing she said was that, wow, you look very polished. And it's very interesting because my background and my history has been anything but polished. But if you didn't know my past or my history, you wouldn't know that. Coming from a single-parent household, in a Crown Heights section of Brooklyn, I struggled a lot, you know, growing up in terms of like my poor background. And coming to Stony Brook University was very intimidating. As a matter of fact, the first time I came to this university was during orientation. I couldn't afford to come out to Stony Brook to look at the campus. I couldn't afford to come to Admitted Student Day because I came from a single parent household and the funds were just not available. So coming to a university, I was very afraid. And the thing that made me feel comfortable, my current counselor is Francisco Colon, and the first thing that he said was like, "Hey, what's up, Pierre? You look familiar." He had never met me before, but that was the first thing he said, and that just put me at ease. So I say that EOP has been very instrumental in terms of my success because of that support system. Being away from home, being on campus, you need a support system. I don't have that support system back home because of my single parent household, but EOP has kind of been like a family to me. It's like I can go to my counselors and just talk to them, and when I need something, they'll be able to provide it. For like another quick example, just to you know, draw you into my story, I remember my freshman year, I always liked to dress up, but I didn't have, and it's an odd story, but I had a white shirt under. But it was the same white shirt that I had from middle school, and it had MS-394, and I was wearing a white shirt, so you could see the black letters through the white shirt. And then Jarvis was like, "Hey, you know, you need a regular white tee." And embarrassingly enough, I had to say that I don't have a white tee. I can't afford to buy more white tees. I don't even have the means to go off campus because I don't have a card to buy a white tee. And he was like, "All right, we'll set up an appointment." So like the following week, he took me out and he bought me white tees. So that's something, I mean, and it's something that a lot of EOP students could have in common, this fact that there's a support system and that there's counselors looking out for us.
Thank you, Pierre.
You're welcome.
Now, I know, Diana, in Paris, you have similar but different experiences. So who's next?
Well, I'll go. I think my success at Stony Brook has depended on different factors.
We anticipated. Diana's got a small, right?
Yes. Okay. My success at Stony Brook has depended on different factors. Mostly, I would say my family. My personality, my goals, and what I want to do as an undergraduate, and also having the Mark Fellowship. And it's a fellowship that's offered to minorities in science that want to pursue a PhD. So what you have to do is you have to work in a lab here, do research, and maintain a B average or above. And they will give you a very nice stipend. You don't have to work. You just have to go to class, do well, and do research. And because of that, and because of the financial stability that Mark has provided me, I've been able to focus on being a student, on engaging in my education, on learning, doing research, learning things outside of the classroom, and being a science major it takes education, it takes hard work. If I didn't have that, if I didn't have the opportunity to do research, to go to Yale last summer and go back this summer, I would have never realized that this is something I want to do for the rest of my life. So because of the opportunities that I've had here that have made me successful here, I've also been able to make decisions about my future and what I want to do, which is an MD PhD. my family has also been important because they push me, they give me advice. Both of my parents were biochemistry majors and they expect me to do well in science and to pursue a science degree. And it's good to have that support system from back home. And my personality has also helped because I'm a little bit shy, but I'm not shy when it comes down to my education and my professional goals in my career. If I keep my ears open, get my ears open to opportunities like Mark Fellowship, when I hear about them, I go after them and I try to do the best I can.
Okay, Paris, I know things are somewhat different for you. What is your response?
Well, I would like to start by saying, as far as like my background, I'm not your expected low income. Both my parents and my grandparents, my whole family, are all highly college educated. I've been expecting to go to school for a long time. And as far as my income, throughout my life, I've been placed with different families due to my mother's illness. She has multiple sclerosis. And through kindergarten and junior high school and high school, I've been living with different types of families. So when I talk about poor, like, I've been around people or I've been living with people who have had income, but as far as me, everything that I have comes from me. Everything that I have, everything that I do, I support myself. So as far as Stony Brook, when I came, you know, it's similar to Pierre. Like, I don't have a way to get here. I don't know how I'm going to get here. My school, I'm from Bayshore. My school brought me to campus when I was in high school, and I met my current faculty advisor, Deborah, in high school, and she told me, she's like, you know, you're going to do great. You should join my group. That I have, I can be there as access, a mentor for you. And I think that was my beginning of the connection to Stony Brook. And I guess I could say that was my gateway to the plethora of different types of faculty who helped me in a similar way. At Stony Brook, I get assistance from so many different types of people. They go out of their way with Deborah, with my group. I also I interact with the faculty and staff and the Dean of Student Suite, and they also assist me. Just the connection, the speaking to them, it doesn't necessarily always need to be advisement or, okay, Paris, are you in class, are you going? It's the constant connection, knowing that they're concerned about me, they want me to do well, they expect me to do well. I feel responsible to be well, to do better. And then as far as my school, I'm very blessed to be part of the School of Social Welfare. And just in general, I've just had a great time interacting with the faculty and staff. Like, as far as like my education, like, and I guess things that have held me back, sometimes it's been hard for me to pay for books or pay for things with school, and my school is committed to my education. There were, I believe when I was a junior, my second semester, I couldn't afford one of my larger books. And you know, it's like, how can you expect to do well if you don't have the book needed for the class? And my dean, she's like, you know, you can use my textbook, it's okay, like, use it for the semester and return it. And for me, like, I was, like, in general, I'm like, I'm shocked by her kindness, but at the same time, I'm like, oh my gosh, like, my school is really committed. Like, she means what she says when she says she wants me to do well. And I've seen that consistently throughout the university. Like, our faculty and staff, I think that's what makes us special, and that's why Stony Brook is that anomaly, that place where students are doing better as compared to other universities.
So you're each talking about the network that you fell into here, either by financial support, Diana, or finding mentors through EOP and through the School of Social Welfare. But what about your peer support? What happens on that level? Some of you talked earlier to me about back home and the pressures there and the friends that you had there, the friends that you have here. What about opportunities to connect with other students?
Can I speak?
Yeah.
I'm president of my organization, Black Women's Weekend, but as a freshman, I was not president. I came in, I functioned as barbecue coordinator, and at that time, I got the opportunity to meet seniors who were getting ready to graduate, people who are actually in my major that I'm in right now. And as far as peer support, they would offer me advice, like, okay, Paris, take this class. You know, if you want to get a good internship, you need to do this. If you want to prepare for grad school, you should start applying at this time. And as far as that network, they've stayed with me throughout my 4 years of school, and even now, getting ready for grad school, I ask them questions like, you know, okay, what is the school like? How can I prepare so that I'm ready for school?
Just to follow up on Paris, as it relates to finding your network at Stony Brook University, this is such a large and vast campus that a lot of times when students come in, they can get lost. Like, there's just a ton of things going on. There's a ton of programs going on. There's different departments. And essentially, as a student coming to Stony Brook, you have to have that mentality that you have to be a go-getter. And it can be very intimidating because you have these faculties, you have these administrations, they have multiple degrees, and they're on their wall. And imagine you're coming in as a student, and you're walking into their office, and you're just trying to start up a conversation. That can be very intimidating. But Stony Brook is such an atmosphere that in order to survive, you have to do that. And it kind of creates an atmosphere that you have to come out of your comfort zone. And if you come into Stony Brook timid, by the time you graduate, you're going to not be timid anymore. And the way it works with the undergraduate colleges is you're surrounded by people who have the same interests and the same like mentalities. So it's kind of, you just vibe together. And then you join clubs and you join organizations like the Student African American Brotherhood. And you meet people and you find out that you have the same thing in common. Because coming back from back home, not everybody may have the same mentality that they want a degree, they want to be successful in life, or they want to pursue higher education. But in the atmosphere at Stony Brook University, everyone wants to be successful. And it just so happens that you surround yourself around people that they're looking for life beyond, you know, for 4 years. They're looking to get their master's degree, or they're looking to get their PhD. So it's being a Stony Brook student is a lot. You have to be aware of your surroundings, and you have to be aware of who you interact, because they're going to define who you are, and they're going to define how successful you are in the end.
Did you want to say anything, Diana?
Well, I'll say that I transferred here in 2010, And that first semester, that first month, I thought I made a mistake. I felt lost. I felt like I didn't know anyone. Nobody knew me. And thankfully, I was able to meet Dr. Bynum and Dr. Maloney, and they've been a great support system. I know that I can, if I have problems with anything, I can turn to them for advice. So I've been lucky, but other students might not be as lucky. So you have to find a support system. You have to find people that will guide you, like Deb said.
Right. So we know that the three of you are successful, and we've heard, Diana, you said you recognized the opportunities and went for them. We've just heard, Paris, you weren't afraid of asking, right? You took advantage of the paths and took on the challenge of getting out of your comfort zone. And so some of us might say, well, Stony Brook's doing a pretty good job. You know, there are enough opportunities there, enough people to find, to connect with. What more do we have to do? So I'm challenging you to challenge us to think about what might Stony Brook have done that would have made that path a little bit easier, or if not for yourself, what you've noticed.
If I can answer that question first. just something that Stony Brook could have done a little bit better. I heard about Stony Brook University through my other peers when I was in high school. They're like, oh, Stony Brook is an awesome school, but they never came here. I kept hearing good things about Stony Brook. It's good at math and science, but you know, we had colleges come and visit, but they never visited my school. I went to school, Megan's College Preparatory School in Crown Heights. And something that Stony Brook could do better, I know EOP has the High School Initiative Program, but as a university, I felt that their presence wasn't felt in my neighborhood. So that gives me the impression, if I'm a student, if I'm going to Stony Brook University, will I be welcome or will I not be welcome? It kind of gives you the feeling like, will I belong when I get here? Or like Cheryl just said, you know, there may be some faculty members that feel like if the student is, you know, underprepared, then they don't belong to be here. If that's the case, then those students that graduate from EOP University, those students that graduated from EOP, would not have had the chance to gain a degree. So I would say that something that Stony Brook University, it can branch out a little bit more.
And once students get here, it's not enough just to get them here. They need that advice and the guidance throughout their 4 or 5 years. If there's someone that's interested in science and they get here and they say, well, I like science, I'm interested in doing research, but they feel like they have to work to pay for car insurance, cell phone bill, or help their families back at home, they might choose a different major to be able to work. And so that right there is wasting potential. And so I feel like sometimes when I walk into a science class, Latinos are not, they're there, but not maybe in the proportion that they should be. And so I feel like programs like offering TA opportunities, you know, positions for them, work study, or having a program where students, as they come in as freshmen, they have tutoring service, they maybe get a book stipend, and they also, after they take the classes and do well, they can tutor other students and get paid for that. I think that will help them to excel in their classes. You learn by teaching, so that's helping them, and there's also giving them a salary so that they can take care of the other responsibilities they have.
I think that along with educational help, low-income students need the social tools to get to where they're going. And as far as like my experiences, like there have been times where I haven't had food. Like I haven't had food, I haven't had things, and I'm blessed to have people who have given to me. But that's part of the network that I've established. All students don't have that. So there are times when students, we don't eat, or we'll find a way, like we'll share very, very struggling meals in order to get through the week. And I think that stuff like that, like you can have a student who's very ambitious and that wants to do well, but like if they're hungry, like what can they do? And or like the student who wants to get ready for that interview or that job, but can't get to the mall, like Pierre said, like before I came to Stony Brook, I didn't know how to dress in business wear. I didn't have a clue. I didn't have business clothes. Who's gonna assist me? Who's gonna take me there? I need assistance in getting there aside from my education. And there are places and there are opportunities, like if you establish a relationship with someone or if you find someone, but then there are students who maybe aren't as proactive or aren't ambitious as me that still need the help.
So So money certainly is an issue, but what about some of the other challenges that you experienced? I know you all worked, well, Diana, you were working through a science lab, right? But the other, Pierre and Paris, you were working on top of studying. Do you want any comments about that?
It's not uncommon to see a student on campus, whether they're EOP or non-EOP, working two or three jobs on campus. It's just that, you know, Stony Brook University accepts a lot of students with lower income, and in order to get the basic needs, let's say to buy a toothbrush or, you know, to eat, a lot of times I feel like when faculty members automatically see a student sleeping in class, they think, oh, that student just is bored or doesn't care about the lecture. No, that student may have been up till like 1 o'clock in the morning working, had to study till 3 o'clock, had 3 hours of sleep, had to get up the next day and go to class. So those are some of the things that student fakes. Some students are overburdened, you know, with work hours, and then if they're involved on campus, they have leadership positions. And then at the end of the day, it seems like you're doing all these things, and then you have to remind yourself, okay, I'm a student. I'm at Stony Brook to earn a degree. So these are some of the challenges that a student face in terms of, like, there's a whole bunch of things that are happening in between the day, and when they finally, at the end of the day, can get a chance to get to their studies, it's like they feel, like, overwhelmed. So that's why probably students, like, struggle in their classes, because there's just a lot of things going wrong.
Also, I think as far as, like, I guess, the occurrences of students who are low income, we often have issues at home that go on. And what happens often is sometimes I feel overwhelmed, like, what do I do? They want me to come home, they want me to deal with their problems. Should I go home? But I have a test, I have a program, I have things to do. Having someone to speak to assists in that, someone who used to be a student who's in the position where you want to be to tell you, okay, Paris, right now you should focus on this. This might be stressing you out right now. It's gonna be okay, like, you're gonna survive. Especially when you go to a school like Stony Brook, like, a lot of my peers, they don't struggle in the same ways that I do. So when I interact with them, it just feels like I don't belong here, like something is wrong, something is missing. Having someone to tell you, no, it's okay, you're almost there, like pushing you along, it goes a long way in assistance with you, like your academics.
So do we need to be doing more with families? Or the family orientation, or what might be a solution or an intervention for us?
I think, well, for some families don't want to be involved, and or I know Pierre and I discussed before that our parents aren't really that interested in us going to grad school. They see it as, you know, you got your bachelor's, you're done, you know, going to school. No, I'm going to grad school. I think just having, like, I feel like as far as parents, once they send their kids to school, they expect them to stay there. So if you're going to assist the person or the student with their social and family life, just that, once again, that support and saying, okay, you can go to grad school. It might be a lot, but there's opportunities, there's fellowships. Making students aware. Before I came to Stony Brook, I wasn't aware of the many ways that you could pay for your PhD. I thought that, oh, there's no way I'm gonna get that. There's no way. Grad school is expensive, there's no way. I'm completely unaware that there are lots of PhD programs that pay you to go there. Like, that's something that I never would have gotten from my parents because they're not really interested. They want me to, you know, begin working so that I can begin supporting myself.
So are there things that we haven't talked about that you wanted to make sure that you said, either about the things that you found really helpful here that we should continue doing, or things that were in your mind, gee, I wish Stony Brook could do whatever? Are there other things that were in your mind?
They don't shy away from stressing that. But a lot of times as a student, you feel like if I'm not a bio major, if I'm not a chemistry major, then I'm not doing anything important. That's not true. So I think that maybe the counselors or the university as a overall should emphasize that you don't necessarily have to be a bio major, you don't necessarily have to want to become a doctor to be successful. I'm a political science major, and I'm very happy to be a political science major because that's something I'm interested in. And not only is that something I'm interested in, that's something I'm good at, so that I can use that to be successful. But a lot of students, they feel that they're struggling in their science or math classes, or they're getting C's, and they feel that they have to be that major. Like, they can't venture out and do other things. And not only that, a lot of other departments on campus get neglected as well. You know, they get their budgets cuts, and it's like the priority only goes to the math and science department. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but we can't neglect those other students that are in other concentrations because they can be just as successful.
I have one very specific suggestion. Last semester, actually, I think it was during the winter break, we had a student who died while
can you can yeah could use
last semester we had a student who died while traveling to a job orientation on a bicycle on 347. The student was hit in a hit and run accident. The driver was drinking and driving. However, I don't think that student should have been there. I feel like the university already has a bus system, the big red and white buses that travel around campus. They also go off campus during the weekends in the morning time to go to places like where students can work, for those students who have to work. But as far as nighttime or as far as like the days like Sundays, like that, those opportunities aren't available to students. So for that student, I don't feel like there's no reason why he should be there. There's no reason, like, I'm not sure of how much it would cost or what it could take, but like I'm pretty sure that there are other students who are finding ways to travel. Maybe they're walking, or my own sad example, when last year while I was working at the mall, once again I don't have transportation, and on New Year's Day there's no buses at all. There's no Stony Brook transportation, there's no anything. I walked there from Stony Brook, which was a 2-hour walk. Very ambitious, very driven. And you know, I'm very like, you know, I think I'm handling it. I get there and then I faint at work. Mm-hmm. Amongst the embarrassment of I guess feeling like overwhelmed, like my job, I'm like, oh my gosh, like what's wrong with her? Why is she fainting at work? It's hard. Like I still, like I need to go to work. I need to be there. What can I do? I can give you all that I have, but if I don't have the tools, like how can I get there? So I feel like as far as specifically students who want to work, there should be more assistance in getting them places.
Right. Diana, anything finally? No. Okay. Well, I'm sure as we were talking that there were questions that you had as well for our students and for our respondents. But let's give everybody a round of applause, please. So we're going to open for questions from the audience, but before we do, can I just do an audience check? Did everybody hear the questions? Is the acoustics enough, or should we? Do you need more access to the mics? Everyone's okay. You've got to raise your hand if you can't hear a question, correct? If you have index cards and you want someone to read your question, pass it down and the SED students will collect it. But before we take questions from the audience, I'd like to open up to our panel and students and respondents and Dr. Engle to see if there are any clarifying questions or any comments or dialogue into change in terms of what you've heard in this part of the program.
No questions at all, but I just wanted to congratulate our student panelists. I just thought they were phenomenal.
Yes.
And while Paris is not a student in our program, I know that she's an EOP affiliate. She's friends with many of our students. And I didn't know a lot about her prior to today, and I'm just so impressed with how she has been able to do so well in spite of the barriers that have been presented.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah, it's funny. I kind of thought of an analogy from my youth when I first started working in Oklahoma. I worked for Shell Oil Company. I worked in their data center, and we used to take, and they got more, and I opened envelopes to collect the credit cards that we would handle to merge them together and bill customers from all over the country. The only business in Tulsa that got more mail was Oral Roberts, who I don't know if you would know, that's an aside. But anyhow, what they taught us was, you value each one of those cards, those that comes in. You pay attention to each one of it. It's worth a certain amount of money. It was like $8, and you had to watch it through the. You had to pay attention through the whole system, not that you carried a card through, but they taught us to value every one. If we could, you know, and that's not a big deal in the scheme of things. If at the university we could have a similar philosophy about students, where each student who comes in here we really value, we place a value on them when they come. And we give them the support that they need, and we place a value on them when they go. There are many ways to do that, but it seems to me like it would be a good thing to emphasize. And I also want to thank the panel. It's inspirational when I hear young folks talk like that.
Mm-hmm. And I would just say, you know, again, your stories were really, I think, moving for all of us. And what I think struck me the most is, you know, how do we seek to institutionalize the kind of support that you all found, you know, and in some cases there were structures in place to make sure that you got that support. In other cases, you happened to meet someone who then became the person that you turned to throughout your career here, or you happened to find out that that scholarship was available. So how do we make sure that students don't feel lucky to have received that kind of support? How do we make sure that it's really a real opportunity that enough students can know what supports are available and take full advantage of them?
Okay, so let's hear from the audience, please. Questions? Yes.
My question is, because like situations like Paris, who are students that are not necessarily within the EOP program, but also not necessarily the population of students that were the average of the 80,000. Like, is there any talk or possibility of having like a mentoring or type program that may not necessarily give funds like EOP does for school, but also provide that support for those students who are like Paris that aren't in the EOP program?
There used to be a mentoring program through the academic advising department. I don't know what happened to that. That was, am I dating myself? I don't know what happened.
It was a wonderful program, Deborah, and I just want to point out Dr. Robbins has actually assembled a group of faculty and staff members at the university to really look at issues of diversity on campus, and that's something that came up at our last meeting. We had a wonderful mentor program here at the university that really worked primarily with underrepresented and first-generation college students, and I don't know what happened to it either, but there has certainly been talk about reviving that program because I really think it made a difference, not just for the students, but it made a difference for us as faculty and staff. It was an opportunity for me as a new advisor here at the university when I first came here to get to know other faculty and staff who were equally committed to meeting the needs of the student population. So the plan is hopefully to revive something like that.
All the way in the back. Yes, yep. Yes.
See, for the students, you've really talked a lot about your jobs while you were up here, and I think this is something that people go back and forth with a lot, how jobs impact student success. So in some camps, people think that jobs are stretching students too thin. At other camps, jobs will help you guys feel like you're involved or have a place on campus. So I'm wondering from your experience, how did your jobs, either off campus or on campus, have an impact on your success here?
Well, as a freshman and sophomore, I had work study, so I was able to work on campus, working in the Student Activities Office and with Liberty Partnerships Program. As far as like student involvement, because I was in the Student Activities Office, I could interact with more students, all the student groups and clubs. And as far as my time and my work, I was also able to do work there. So as far as that, the opportunity was great. Like, it gives me a chance to network more on campus, to meet new people. But as far as my internship that I have right now off campus, it's a new opportunity to meet people and learn about myself. But it's a little bit harder and stressful in general because I'm concerned, like, okay, I need to get there, I need to get back. I'm not working, it's not a paid internship, so I'm not working. So how am I gonna facilitate get the money to get there? So as far as like opportunities, I feel like work study opportunities, you'll generally get that type of sentiment from students, that they really enjoy them because they get to sort of relax while working.
For research, the PIs are understanding that you're a student, but it can also be overwhelming at times when they expect you, like sometimes they actually forget that you're an undergraduate and they think that you're a graduate student and expect you to be in the lab like full time. Like my PIs at the beginning of the semester said, oh, you're gonna be in the lab full time this semester. I'm not gonna be in the lab full time, I'm gonna be more available, but it can be challenging at times, but it also helps because if you do research, I don't do research in the biochemistry department, it's my major, but I do research in the ecology department, so it's different fields, but I still get to learn a lot of things about ecology, and I'm an ENS minor, so it helps for my minor in understanding the content of the class better.
Did you want to say anything, Pierre?
Although I was kind of like forced into having to work because of my socioeconomic status, I don't regret it, though. Every job that I've had on this campus has helped me grow as an individual and grow professionally. Without those jobs, I would not have been able to know how to write a resume or write a cover letter or, you know, how to conduct myself during staff meetings or public speaking. So although, you know, working can be a burden sometimes because you do have classes, but it helps you build that professional, those professional skills that other students that don't have campus jobs probably wouldn't be able to get.
My question is about outreach. Pierre, you said that we didn't have admissions council moving to your high school, and you know about Stony Brook, and we have Paris that's fully active in bus groups. What are some ways that you feel that Stony Brook can outreach to maybe the local schools in the city, schools that aren't recognized or touched upon?
Well, I know this semester that the admissions office started bringing schools here, and they have panels to speak to them. But I wasn't aware of that, if that was going on as a freshman. But I would say that as it relates to, you know, having reaching out to students, it's one thing to bring the students to campus, but then almost when they come to campus, I guess try to have the other departments kind of like welcome them in as well. So if students are coming to campus and I'm a student, I'm speaking to them as well, if they have, if they're interested in, let's say, you know, biology, or they're interested in, you know, other departments on campus, it would be good if they can come out as well and meet those students so that they can feel like they're welcome, and that they feel that when they do come here in the fall, they know exactly where to go to and they know exactly how to navigate the campus.
I think next week we're going to, I think, William Floyd School District to speak to elementary. I'm going with the admissions to speak to them. And I feel like more opportunities like that would be good for students and good for the students there, because a lot of times, like, these high schools or the elementary schools can't bring their students here. If you can just take one or two or three students and, you know, carpool them there and say, you know, speak to this population at different levels, I think that it's great that we're speaking to an elementary school. People have been speaking to me about college since kindergarten. So I think that, like that's what we should do. There should be more opportunities for us to leave campus and go to schools in the area, and then go to schools farther in Brooklyn, like so that students like Pierre, like, they'll have an opportunity to speak to a Stony Brook student.
I think all the way in the back.
My question is actually for Cheryl. I'm a UP student myself, and actually when I was looking at some of the slides, I was actually UP class 2002, and I remember you talked about the GPA, the minimum being 80, you know, 80%. That's my GPA when I got into the program.
Right.
As Stony Brook is tougher and tougher, has there been a push to increase that GPA?
Not necessarily. We work very closely with our Office of Admissions, and our Office of Admissions is equally committed to access. So we want to make sure that we are providing access to our program. Many of our students, you know, our students' SAT scores don't necessarily reflect their potential. It just reflects where they are. And our goal as a program is to meet the students where they are and to help to bring them up to where they need to be successful. So we've enjoyed a very positive relationship with our Office of Admissions, and we work closely with them to make sure that we are maintaining our commitment to access.
Yes?
This is a question for the students. I know that each of you discussed special programs like EOP or the School of Social Welfare and the Biology Department, so programs and departments that you felt connected to. But do you feel like the university, the institution of Stony Brook, do you feel connected to them when they're doing things like increasing your tuition costs but offering you less courses, or making you take classes in the summer and winter, which spreads out your financial aid package more than we can give you financial aid in the winter? So while you're getting the support from these special programs and departments, how do you feel about the institution as a whole?
It's interesting that
it's okay to be honest. You know.
It's interesting that you asked that question, because we was actually having a discussion about that in my leadership development class. I feel that a lot of times students get the perspective that the university doesn't feel like they're dealing with actual people. So a lot of times it's like papers and it's like numbers, but no, these are people. So universities are not for-profit, you know, they're not for-profit businesses. They're here to educate students. And a lot of times when students have to go to multiple departments or go to multiple people's just to, let's say, register for classes or, you know, solve a problem, it can be a hassle. It feels like they're being pulled in a whole bunch of different directions. There's no sense that there's this central location that a student can go to and they can voice their complaints or they can express their needs. So I say that as a Stony Brook student, there is this general vibe to say that you get lost, and it's a general vibe that people don't feel like you're a student, that you're just a number. So yeah.
I would agree that it is frustrating every time we see a new fee or we see a tuition increase, but I do enjoy the many different opportunities that the university provides to me. I know that they're not free and they're not cheap. So on one hand, it's like you get frustrated and I feel like, okay, I wish that, like, you know, my tuition cost was lower, but at the same time, like, I do feel very, very connected to my university through all the things that I've been through. It's hard for me to leave. In going to grad school, I don't want to leave Stony Brook. It's so hard. Whether I get into other schools or not, it's hard for me to say I want to. I'm ready to go, and I feel like that speaks to my connection to my university.
Diana, has it met your father's? You want to share your the story about your dad?
Okay, so the reason why I decided to come to Stony Brook after all was Perry was because my dad, he grew up in Colombia. I grew up in Colombia too. And his dream was to come to, you know, Stony Brook to study here. I don't know how he heard about it. I don't know how he applied, but that was his dream. And because of financial reasons, he wasn't able to make it. So when we got here, he always pushed for Stony Brook. I never understood why until I got here, and he had to pick me up after a bio 203 exam, and he told my mom, like, oh, this was my dream. I wish I would have been able to come here. But he told me recently that he doesn't care. He said, I'm old now, I don't care, but if you make it, if you graduate and you have the opportunities that I didn't get, then I'll be happy and I'm satisfied.
So has it met his expectations and yours?
Yes, he's very proud.
Mm-hmm. Yes, in the back.
I'm really interested in hearing what you speak about the sense of community and life within the groups. I know there was questions that were prompted a little bit earlier about that peer support. But, you know, what is life like? What are your friendships like? Do you live, is your roommate or suitcase the same, you know, fellow Canadian students, or who are those people? What's the dynamics that are involved there?
All right, so you come in as an EOP student straight out of Summer Academy, and you already know like 149 or 150 people, which is awesome. So you come into school in the fall, and everybody's like, did you go to high school together? No, you came through the EOP Summer Academy. So that's great. So EOP is like your foundation, is like where you start off. But as you go through your sophomore or your junior year, it's kind of expected, and the counselors kind of push you to branch out. So you branch out to meet other students that are not EOP. You branch out to different clubs or different organizations. So it ends up that junior or, you know, senior year, your roommate may not be EOP. And that's perfectly fine, because you want to be more, you want to make your circle bigger. You want to meet people with different interests, with different backgrounds. And I think that's what makes, that's what helps you build as a person. That's what helps create the sense of community, the fact that you're not only staying in your own comfort zone, but you're interacting and you're part of a bigger pool or a bigger circle.
Well, as far as like my sense of community, I never leave campus ever. I stay here indefinitely. I stay here through the winter and the summer. So as far as like my connection, I'm like, as far as friends and like my circle, it's grown a lot and it's very close at the same time. Of course, when you're in college, you make some of your best lifelong, long-lasting friends, and I feel like I have that at Stony Brook, and I don't think that I would have that at a smaller university or if I was a commuter student and I didn't have the opportunity to stay on campus.
You probably all know that science classes are very large here at Stony Brook, and when I transferred here as a transfer student, it's hard to make friends. I only knew one person when I came to Stony Brook, and going to class, it was hard to make friends because everyone has their group of friends. They're sometimes not open to meeting new people, but I've been lucky. I've gotten to know other biochemistry majors. Mostly my friends are biochemistry major, bio majors. And through your classes, for example, the Undergraduate Biochemistry Society, and going to seminars, you meet other people, you meet people that are like you, that have similar goals, they want to go to medical school, want to do an MD, PhD. So it's hard, it was for me as a science major and being in large classes, but you eventually find a group of people that you can relate to and you have similar you share similar ideas.
Jeff, did that answer your question? Did you want to follow up with anything? Okay. Anything else from the audience? Yes.
I'd just like to ask Cheryl, in terms of the support that you provide EOP students in the non-academic setting, so when many of these students mentioned that they often felt like they didn't belong or they felt like they were floundering or, you know, sort of the psychological, emotional needs of EOP students, what are some of the interventions or some of the things that you do in terms of the mentoring relationships you help develop with these students?
Well, certainly, as I mentioned, we use a caseload model and we have advisors who meet with our students throughout the semester. I mentioned that our students have to meet with their advisors at least three times a semester, but they're meeting with their advisors ongoing. So it's not unusual for our students to come in to meet with their advisors when they're dealing with social adjustment issues. And so the unique thing about our program and what differentiates EOP from the typical advising unit on campus is that our advisors are not just academic advisors. They are personal counselors. We provide personal counseling, developmental counseling, career counseling, financial aid, and financial counseling in terms of budgeting. So it's really a more holistic approach. I know that in Dr. Engle's presentation, she talked about coaching. And coaching, in this case, is being done in groups. And we certainly have group workshops for our students to address some of their social adjustment issues. But also, when the students go in to meet with their EOP advisors, there's a lot of coaching that happens there as well, just in terms of making that transition from their home community to the academic community.
Yes.
Support systems for students after they graduate, so that if they don't go to grad school, they want to enter the job market, is there a way to
One of the things that we do as a program, we have a very active EOP alumni group. Our program has been around since 1968, so we have thousands of successful alumni who've left this program and who've gone on to become doctors and lawyers and teachers and engineers, and we bring them back, not just to talk to our students. Our freshmen meet our alumni in their summer academy. The alumni come back during the summer to talk about their careers. That keeps the alumni connected with the program, and it also lets our freshmen know that here's somebody who looks like me, who came from the same background as me, with the same challenges as me, who's gone on to be successful. So again, those informal mentoring relationships start early, but it also keeps our alumni connected. So when our alumni, and again, I've been here for a long time, so it's not unusual for a student who was my student in 2000 to call me to say, you know what, I'm applying for this kind of job. Can you write me a recommendation? Can you give me some job leads? That kind of thing. So EOP, Pierre mentioned that EOP is very much a family. So that family doesn't only include our current students and staff, but it also includes our alumni. I'm not sure if I answered your question. The other nice thing that happens, and as quiet as it's kept, for students who graduate from EOP and who choose to stay within SUNY for graduate school, there is also financial support for that. And for our students who choose to go on to any of the professional schools in SUNY, whether they're going to medical school, law school, or dental school, they are eligible for what's called the First Professional Opportunity Scholarship, which is a full tuition scholarship for professional school within the SUNY system.
Yes.
Maybe ask that question of the students about coaching and mentoring. Was one assigned to you, or do you seek one out on the campus, or do you have one coach or mentor, and then you go on?
Well, I mean, for me, it's a little bit different because I came in as an EOP student. So to me, right off the bat, the people that we went to or our mentors were the peer advisor tutors. They really enforced the idea that even though we came from backgrounds, you know, where we may have had problems or low economic status, that no one's gonna have sympathy for you. No one's gonna have pity for you. When you come to Stony Brook University in the fall, you're a regular Stony Brook student. So it's almost like at a blank slate. And so the peer advisor tutors were like mentors and people that can, you know, give us like the insight on Stony Brook and tell us to what to get involved in, what classes to stay away from, you know, what to be a part of. And then, you know, EOP also has, you know, the TAMP program. But aside from EOP, you gain mentors in different departments, different, I'm close to a lot of faculty on campus. I'm close to a lot of professors. And it almost, there's an environment at Stony Brook that in order to get ahead, you have to meet these people. Because they're the one that tell you about the opportunities. They're the one that tell you about the graduate programs or the fellowships or the different scholarships. So you're not only do you have peer mentors, but you also have older mentors.
I have a lot of different advisement. I have, with my organization, I have my faculty advisor and my program advisor, and they both work with me with my organization for things that I need. But along with that, I come to them for problems. Like, I can talk to them about things, and that relationship has developed over time. And they give me great assistance out of their own time. And then as far as with school, I have another faculty advisor that helps me with my field placement in school. And once again, she goes out of her way to assist me. And once again, like it, I guess the school initiated that because they are my advisors, but they spend more time with me so that I can talk about like my social issues, or I'm not sure about the school, or I'm not sure about you know, what am I gonna do? Where am I gonna work after school? I can go to them for that assistance.
And I think I mentioned that before, my mentors are my PI. He's very approachable. I can ask him any questions. Dr. Bynum, Dr. Maloney are also very supportive, and I know I can go to them with any questions.
I have a question, Dr. Bynum. Your program is not specifically geared for attracting low-income students, correct?
Correct, yeah.
Okay.
That really span the nature of it.
Okay, so I'm interested in hearing, it seems as if some of the things that you're doing are modeled, or not modeled on, but similar to the outreach and the mentoring that occur in EOP AIM. But I'm wondering what you would say about the financial dollar for that, replicating it, or what, you know, I'd like to understand a little bit more. Do you differentiate or do different things for the low-income students, or they come in, the pack that comes in are all dealt with the same, you don't differentiate in any way?
Well, the broad answer is that we don't do a whole lot different unless you're in a specific program. Like for the Bridges program that I mentioned that we started, it, which is a partnership with community colleges, that I didn't mention, with the chancellor's help, we were actually expanding statewide. If you come in that program, we have set activities. We've had reunions. We've had several hundred students go through that. We stay in touch. And part of that is that when you get these kind of grants, you have an obligation to track the students and stay in touch. We would do that anyway, and in all our programs, we kind of have a standard line that once you join with our programs, you're in it for life. And we mean that. I mean, you really are. So in the Bridges program, you know, we've been running it 20 years. We talk about students that we had when we started. In the MARC program, which Diana is in, it's kind of a similar thing. The denominator is smaller, about 100 students. But, you know, one of our most successful ones, Melody Goodman, who was here a student in the late 90s, I mean, and I still am still in touch with her. She was here, and we used to argue all the time. She was pretty, had her own mind. And then so she said, I'm gonna go make money. So she took off and she went to Wall Street, and she majored in statistics here. And I said, you really are an academic. And she went off, and then I talked to her a few years later, and she decided she'd go back and get her PhD in statistics at Harvard, which she did. And then she came back here and joined the faculty here at Stony Brook. And of course, she was a local resource, so we had her come talk to the MARC students and our Bridges students and our majority programs, all our programs, because she was delighted to inspire the next generation just the way she was. And here this was, you know, a young woman from Jamaica, Queens, who, you know, didn't quite know what she was gonna do. Well, she was so good that they hired her away from Stony Brook. Now she's at Wash U in St. Louis, where our president came from. More power to her. I mean, she was a gift while she was here. We had the best time, personally and professionally, and I could tell you a lot of stories like that. So, but our main philosophy is, if you work with us, you know, we don't let you go. You're there, and it doesn't mean that you have to be a star and go be a full professor at Wash U. You can walk in with your life not going so well, and many of us know what that's like from a firsthand experience. And we'll talk it over with you. I'm in an academic department, so we're not in that business. It's not something that we can focus full time on, but we really recognize the importance of it. And my own feeling is the university could do more. We need to find better ways of mentoring and advising and guiding students, make sure that they don't fall through the cracks. And mentoring is tricky because you don't connect with everyone, and you have to find a connection. I've tried to work with some students, and you just don't connect. Some others, as soon as they get off the elevator, you're off to the races. You need to find, a student needs to be a bit proactive, because there are people out there you can connect with. Just keep kind of seeking them out. But we can do better here, and I look forward to talking more with Dr. Engle and, seeing what suggestions we might have. And I can't tell you how much I've enjoyed this, and I feel like I've learned from it. I find it inspirational.
Any other questions from the audience? Yes.
I think it's important to also mention those students. I think there's a great population of students who their income level would be EOP aims, but they met our admissions and product requirements. So they get accepted to the university, and during their first year, I think they get that holistic approach of advising from the undergraduate colleges. So we are their counselors. They come to us for everything. I happen to be one of those advisors. But then they leave us, and then they don't have this 4 or 5 year support system that EOP AIM provides for their low income students. But we have this chunk of low income students who didn't get accepted to that because they met our admissions requirements. And what support are they going to get after they leave their first year, after they leave the undergraduate colleges? So as an institution, it's important not to forget those students.
That's a good question.
You're right. Anything else? Yes, go ahead.
This is for the whole panel. What do you think are some of the challenges that the university faces implementing, advising, and mentoring at a more general level for the general student body, along with what she just said? What are some of the challenges? Because I've been at Stony Brook for about 7 years, so I feel very connected to the community. And I do remember during my undergraduate stay here, advising wasn't, out there in the open. I actually went through the college for about 2 solid years without meeting with an advisor once. So what do you think some of the challenges are for the university to address that?
I would have to say it's a resource issue. Certainly for our program, we're able to provide one advisor for every 100 students. And again, the types of advising that our advisors provide goes well beyond academic advising, so we're able to provide the holistic approach. Unfortunately, for the general student population, I don't think it's possible for the university to come up with the resources to provide one counselor or advisor for every 100 students here at the university and to provide such intensive advising and proactive advising. So resources are a big part of it.
Paris, you wanted to say something?
What I was going to say is that it's a cost issue. It's very expensive to provide that type of resource to students. I think what the university could do, I think that they can mobilize their students. I participate with admissions in their outreach to high school students, and I enjoy doing it, and I do it out of my own free time. And I feel like the university could do that with other seniors with different majors. A senior knows a lot about what it takes to get to graduating, so if the university could somehow find a way to mobilize students in different types of majors and say, okay, this group of 4 students, they're successful in their major, or students that want to inquire, they want to learn, and they want to know what type of courses they should take, what type of internships they should take, just social help in general. Students in general are helpful to other students, and I feel like if we specifically had a place to go to find students, we would see improvement.
Pierre, you had a suggestion related to that too in our earlier discussions, right?
When it comes to peer advising and mentoring, I think it plays a large role in terms of making sure the student stays at Stony Brook. As a Stony Brook student, you need to know that there's people looking out for you. You need to know that there's people pushing you. And it doesn't need to be in a so structured, atmosphere. I have a lot of mentors that aren't necessarily assigned to me, a lot of people that advise me that aren't necessarily assigned to me. But a lot of that goes to the student needs to know that there's someone that they can relate to, or there's someone that looks like them, or there's someone that there's a common interest. I'm not sure, and we talk about diversity, but I'm not sure if there's a lot of diversity in the staff, in the professional staff, because sometimes when I'm looking at it and I see my mentors and I see my advisors, and they're so stretched thin. They're advising so many clubs and organizations, or they're involved in so many things, and sometimes I feel for them, and I'm at the end of the day, the same day I'm a student, at the end of the day, they're a counselor. So I think that I don't know how to say it, but like in terms of the pro staff, having a little bit more diversity so that the students can know that there's someone that looks like them, there's someone similar backgrounds that they can go to and that can, you know, share in the same, you know, experience that they did.
Very good.
May I say something? I think that's a great question, and I don't have the answer, except I do think it is really a resource problem, like most have suggested, but it's also a systems problem, because you can design systems. I mean, the Florida State model, you know, it'd be interesting to know what the commitment was in resources to do those kind of things. But you can simplify systems and simplify ways of doing things that make a place more friendly and more positive. And I think there's a lot that we could do with, I don't think not having the money is a reason to say that we can't do anything, although it's a scarce resource.
Yeah, just to reinforce that, I mean, certainly resources are an issue on every college campus, you know, across the country right now, and it is hard to replicate that kind of one-on-one interaction and what you get from those personal relationships. But, you know, to reinforce your point, I think there are, and we learned from the Florida State example and from some other folks, there are in some ways even technology-driven ways to make that connection, to empower students with information about what their progress looks like, to empower advisors and faculty to know what student progress looks like. And so there are some ways that you can utilize technology to help bridge some of the gap between the resource issue and what students need in terms of information.
Thank you very much indeed. We have achieved our goal for this symposium. Our goal, as I said earlier, was to present issues that are present challenges to campus communities and to engage in a meaningful dialogue about those challenges. And we've achieved that today, I think. And so I want to give another round of applause for our panelists, Dr. Engle, and for ourselves for engaging in this very difficult topic. So we've got a lot of work ahead, but we've begun. So the panelists will be here. We're a little bit early. We aim to end at 12:30. If you want to ask any other questions or be available, please do. But thank you very much for coming for this 17th annual symposium.